FIU involved in the last game ever played at the legendary Orange Bowl. Now a new home is unveiled. Workers busy right up to game time. And today, the 12th-ranked Bulls of South Florida help christen FIU Stadium against the young and hungry Panthers. It's history in the making as FIU charges onto the field inside their brand new stadium for the very first time. Today's ESPNU college football primetime matchup is presented by City. Hi, everybody. I'm Doug Bell. Welcome to Southern Florida, Miami, to be exact. It's exciting to be here. A brand new stadium, brand new era of football at Florida International. That's FIU, the Golden Panthers. We're excited to be here on ESPNU. And when you think about it, FIU's only been around for 7 seasons. South Florida, only 12 seasons of football, and yet they're 12th in the country. It would make major headlines if FIU pulls off the upset on this opening night in their new stadium. Let's go down to the field. And Melissa Knowles.
Coach, how does this moment feel?
Can't describe it in words. It marks the beginning of what we set to do, and that's to build a championship football program. You can see it in our players' eyes, and you can hear in the locker room, emotions are as sky high as they're ever going to be. And let's start doing something special.
Good luck today, Coach.
Thank you very much.
Buck?
Thanks, Melissa. Hey, when you think of South Florida, you think of Matt Grothy. He's a guy that during his career has won 20 games and lost only 8. But what he did this offseason, he lost 20 pounds so he could have more energy, effort, and efficiency. Usually you think of him running. Well, last week versus Kansas, in the third and fourth quarter, he was 21 of 25 with 2 touchdowns. In order for the Bulls to finish strong like they haven't the last 2 years, they need a great effort from Matt Grothy. Doug, back to you.
All right, Buck, thank you. Look forward to you getting back up here in the press box. Here's what's on tap in Miami tonight. New digs, new attitude. We'll talk about what lies ahead for FIU. The coach's crib inside young coach Cristobal. What does his office look like? And yes, USF, their humble beginnings as well. As always, the buck stops right here at FIU Stadium. Major excitement. South Florida brings a host of fans across the state. Not a long drive by any stretch of the imagination, and FIU has their fans, and Coach Cristobal told me yesterday he wasn't sure they would know how to act. This is the first time they've ever been in their own stadium. It is a gorgeous day in South Florida, hot and muggy, as you might expect. FIU won the toss, decided to defer, and here comes South Florida. Bogan returns it and gets knocked down at the 26. So the Bulls coming off an impressive victory in overtime against Kansas last Friday night in Tampa will take to the field. Matt Grothy having his best season, a talented young man who played in Lakeland high school football and has taken it seriously this year as far as his physical makeup. He's lost almost 20 pounds, and his game is quickness. First and 10 now for Grothy. James Taylor lines up to his right. Grothy with lots of time to the outside looking for his big tight end, Cedric Hill. Off the hands of Hill. Let's look at South Florida. Up front, their offensive line. Greg Gregory, their offensive coordinator, said this bunch could be special. Anchor of a bad Funers, their best lineman at left guard. Dial, not bad. Backs and receivers. Cedric Hill is a load at tight end. Dontavia Bogan gets his first start on the outside. Second down now. Murphy under center. You never know what direction South Florida will come. This offense of Greg Gregory. Sometimes shotgun, sometimes under center. Two tight ends to look tonight. And Ryan Schmidt, left tackle, jumps a little early, but I think South Florida is excited, too. A lot of excitement in the stadium.
Well, Doug, if you think back to last year, that Florida-Atlantic game, this is almost a trap game for South Florida. They come into this situation with a hostile crowd and a lot of Florida guys. It's like a family reunion, only in a bad way.
Jim Leavitt told us he expected major passion from FIU, even though they've lost their first 2 games. They've won only 1 game in 3 seasons under Mario Cristobal. But they are Florida kids against Florida kids. Grothy now on second down and long. over the middle, wide open is A.J. Love. As we look at the Panthers up front, a defensive line that actually looks like a major college defensive line, according to their defensive coordinator. He likes what he sees in these guys. The backers, they hustle. Dominguez, we saw him last year, makes a ton of tackles. And in the secondary, their pass defense has really been good. Gator and Mitchell on the corners. Third down and a yard for the Bulls. Looking for a hole, and he gets a huge one as Jamar Taylor. Ball's loose. FIU comes up with it.
Doug, initially, these are the kind of plays you have defensively in order for you to be successful if you're FIU. And that play right there was a very good run initially by Taylor. He does a great job of hesitating. Watch there. And then he takes off behind his big Matt Huners. But there's a good, strong hit inside, and he gives the ball up. Looks like Anthony Gator was the one that hit him initially. The ball comes out. Gator does a good job of hitting him. Then the fumble recovery. It becomes a scrum under there, Doug. You don't know who's going to get that one.
Rotating quarterbacks for the Golden Panthers. Paul McCall will get the start. We will see Wayne Younger tonight. Through the ground game. Julian Reams over the left side. Goes nowhere. Gets hemmed up. Once again, Paul McCall, a junior from Hollywood, Florida, just down the highway, gets the start tonight.
Grad student, Doug. The problem with Paul sometimes, he overthinks.
Mario Cristobal wears a tie on the sidelines, one of the few coaches in the country to do that. He's growing a beard, and I love sitting down and chatting with this man. Boy, does he have major enthusiasm. Excited about what the future holds for this young football program. Back to the ground game. Reams on the delay draw, gets some positive yards, gains five for FIU up front, an offensive line that actually is getting better. Brad Serini on the Rivikin watch list anchors that line at center. Backs and receivers, they haven't had an opportunity to do a lot. Roll and Mertil are talented and very fast on the outside. What you would expect from kids who play their high school football down in this state.
Yeah, and we also see T.Y. Hilton, the freshman who had a great punt return last week. They're expecting, a couple of weeks ago, they really like T.Y. Hilton.
Third down now, back to the ground game. And that'll bring up fourth down as he picks up two. For South Florida up front, you have Bowie and Selby, the bookends, and they're about as good as anybody has in this country. Mompremier, the games we've called Buck, he has been all over the place, double-digit tackles. And then Jerome Murphy trying his best to fill the slot of Mike Jenkins and Trey Williams, and so far, so good.
Yeah, we'll also talk about Ben Moffitt being out throughout the game and what his impact has been on this South Florida defense.
FIU trying to get on the board first, a 52-yard attempt from Dustin Rivas. He decides to punt. Gets a nice bounce. And FIU will down that at the 1 yard line. Beautiful play.
Oh, perfect play. The real reason, though, I thought they would do something on third down to give them an opportunity. They didn't do it.
South Florida with their second possession, fumbled the first time, and now they're back on the one. The Bulls in full force. Their fans making the trek over from Tampa, 12th in the country.
They have that other side packed, Doug. It's like they're isolated on the island, but the South Florida Bulls are used to playing in hostile environments.
They will make plenty of noise. Now Grothy from the 1 yard line backed up. Taylor lined up behind him. Actually, that's Mo Plancher, carries it out to the 2 yard line. Let's get down to the field, and Melissa.
I'm here with the athletic director for FIU, Pete Garcia. Pete, how does it feel to finally have this day here?
Well, it's very exciting for the whole community, for the FIU University. It's something that we worked very hard to get, and to get to this day, it's almost an unreal feeling.
What is it like to face the number 12 team in the country right now, South Florida, in your inaugural game?
Well, that's where we want to be eventually, so if you want to be the best, you got to play the best.
Thanks, Pete.
You're welcome.
Doug?
Melissa, thank you. Pete Garcia, earned his roots at the University of Miami, which is just 6 miles away in Coral Gables, as did Mario Cristobal. Thus the connection, and they do have a vision. Let's see if that's a completed pass to Trent Cupello, the tight end. I do think he caught it.
It looked like it was behind him, but he did a good job of reaching back and digging it out. It's good play here. They're going to work the play action pass, and this is where Grothy has really improved. See right there, he got his hands underneath. Looked like he pulled it in. Here's a better look on that camera. Good hands by Cupello.
A completion of 14 yards, so first and 10. More manageable now for the Bulls from the 16-yard line. Back to the ground. Mo Plancher.
And see, Doug, they're always setting Grothy up. You can see after every play, he's going to roll out. He's going to do things. When they get him in the shotgun, he becomes the zone read guy. But when he's in under center, he will still roll out and give the defense the appearance that you have to keep a couple of guys back to make sure you respect him.
The play results in a gain of 3, bring up a 2nd and 7.
Second and 7 now, and I will say the loudspeaker here at FIU Stadium, it works to perfection. Wow, that is loud. Grothy threw it behind his intended receiver, Carlton Mitchell. That was not a good pass. Jim Leavitt, pregame, as always, a ritual. He runs from sideline to sideline, working up a lather. No other coach does this, Buck. I mean, he is into it.
Usually, though, he's running full go. He must have something wrong, bad ankle or knee or something, because usually he's out there, he's sweating like he's played already.
An interesting man. Grothy pulls it down, showing those quick feet. He knows where the first down marker is and gets out of bounds after making the first down. That's what makes Matt Grothy the weapon he is.
It is, and there's going to be a flag on that play, Doug. Looked like it might be a late hit.
The carry by number 8.
The thing with Grothy is that he also now, even though he can run very effectively, Doug, what he does a very good job of now is he's looking for the second and third guy, even when he's scrambling.
After the play was over, personal foul, unnecessary roughness, number 67 on the defense, 15-yard penalty, first down.
Dennis Hennigan, Big East officiating crew, he's the referee with a call.
He feels the pressure there, and then he just decides, okay, can I throw it? And whenever a quarterback pulls that ball up or puts it up like he's going to throw it, the defense has to respect that. So he knows it now, and being his third year playing this position, he realizes if they hesitate, I have a chance to go.
First and 10 as Grothy looks to the sidelines, and Greg Gregory setting up that screen. That was great pursuit. Coming up to make the stop is Anthony Gator. And as we watch tape, this kid's impressive.
He flies around the football. They have some very physical guys in that secondary. Gator is one. Jeremiah Witherspoon at 6'2", 215, another big hitter. But what I like about Gator, two times in a row, he forced the fumble on the last play. And on the screen, you usually have this first guy that has to come and force contain. He doesn't get blocked, but does a good job of pressing and making a play.
Second down for South Florida. You think about FIU now, their first game in their on-campus stadium. Only the 7th season of football at FIU. Flag down before the snap. It'll be procedure against South Florida. That'll be against Cedric Hill, who can't believe they called it on him. He was actually moving forward just before the snap.
He's the most important guy in this offense, talking to Greg Gregory. He just does so much. He can be a wide out. He can play H-back, tight end. Doug, the other thing, you told me something interesting. We're either in Broward or Dade County, according to where we're sitting. And you're on one side of the 50. I'm on the other. So
that's right. The county line runs right down the sidelines of FIU, basically a few feet back. And this stadium, old Tamiami Stadium, longtime high school facility, and now it's the home of the Golden Panthers. And it will be busy on Thursday and Friday nights as well for the high schools. Grothy throws it up and out of bounds, and he takes a nice pop. Took a shot from Jonathan Betancourt.
Well, he had a lot of time, but the one thing that I saw, Doug, is that man coverage. They had everyone covered, and they did a very good job of having one guy in the middle. Paul Galliano always says we're going to have one guy in the middle, or we're going to play cover two. They play a lot of cover two, Florida International does, and they want to pressure you, but they have to get those front four guys playing well.
Grothy is off to a fine start, and when you look at his career, it is an accumulation of a young man who is getting better with time, as most quarterbacks do, over the middle. And there's a catch, a beautiful throw, threading the needle. A.J. Love on the receiving end, going up and getting it.
Great job by A.J. Love. I talked about Jeremiah Weatherspoon being a big hitter, but A.J. Love had no fear. And Matt Grothy has way too much time. And here we talk about that cover two look, but great job. Weatherspoon looked like he didn't know to go for the pick or hit the guy. And see, when he was indecisive, that hesitation, Doug, gave A.J. Love, who has probably been practicing the best, according to Greg Gregory, on this team, a chance for a big play.
That was a 31-yard pickup. Back to the ground it goes. Working his way forward. 7-yard pickup. That was Richard Kelly. When you look at Grothy now, he may look a little different to you. And Greg Gregory told us after the spring he was about 218 pounds. And he flat out told him, if we're going to win a title, you need to get in better physical shape. Now he's under 200 pounds. He's got the quickness back. This is the Grothy of high school.
And I'm surprised Grothy didn't karate chop him. He's a black belt in karate, but he took it good. Took it well.
Loose football again. And I think Kelly got it back. FIU says they have it. South Florida signaling that they still have it. And it appears the Bulls will stay on it. Kelly picked up 7 his first carry and 18 on that jaunt.
Doug, we have a stable of running backs with South Florida. Kelly, not even on the depth chart, but getting a chance to play, took a big shot at the end of that run. That's the one thing I told you, watching these guys play on film, Marshall McDuffie was the one that knocked that ball out. They do a very good job of coming up, really trying to strike you. Florida International does.
Mo Plancher spins off a tackler, heading for that pylon. We get wrestled down inside the 5. Marshall McDuffie saved a touchdown. But you called it.
Yeah.
I mean, they have a stable of running backs. We're seeing fresh backs every couple of plays.
Jamar Taylor, Ben Williams, Mo Plancher. Well, and, you know, Mike Ford is hurt right now. See, the play starts to the left, and then it comes back to the right. You see those guys are outflanked right there. Jeremiah Weatherspoon. So what do they do? Marshall McDuffie has to come over and attack and make the play. You see, once they went inside and lost contain, boy, they knew they were in trouble. They better thank Marshall McDuffie for saving that touchdown.
That was a 13-yard pickup. So it's been a 7-yard, 18, and a 13-yard carry back to the ground.
Wow.
Taking a nice shot was Mo Plancher. Ball. And they lost the football again. And once again, the Panthers say they have it, and I think they do. Haven't gotten the official signal. No, they say South Florida still has it. The line judge came in. Tyler Clausen came up with that ball for FIU, but the line judge is calling the man down before the ball came out.
We're going to take a look right here. Great shot right there by Jeremiah Weatherspoon. Ball comes out after his arms hit the ground. But look, Jeremiah Weatherspoon, I told you, he missed last year because of academic issues. The ball doesn't come out until he hits the ground. Good look by the camera crew. They're going to want to look at this again. I know Mario Cristobal will. And that's a smart challenge for them. Even though they won't win it, according to our camera look.
Well, they will look at our replays. Yes. In fact, Todd Kulis, our producer, who's celebrating his birthday today, is getting the call now from the booth. The makeshift booth, that is. Because they don't have everything finished here in the new stadium. And they will look at this replay right here. And his elbow is down before the ball comes out. At least that's the way I see it, Buck.
Yeah, the same here, Doug. I mean, he took a shot from Weatherspoon and almost kept his balance. That's what Mo Plancher does a very good job of. But it looks like his hand and his elbow were down before the ball came loose. What I will say about Florida International, this is a totally different team than I saw 2 years ago. They will come up and hit you. The problem they have offensively, they've been pathetic. And that's where they need to improve, because their defense plays so much and so long that it keeps them on the field. And in a hot day like today, or when you're playing Iowa or Kansas, you really don't have a chance to do much.
Mario Cristobal was an outstanding offensive tackle at the University of Miami. And it was an interesting story, as he told me yesterday in his office, and I love being around him. He just is so full of energy. Said when FIU called and wanted to interview him for the head coaching job, he said he went there as a courtesy. His mom her house is like four blocks away. He said, how could I tell my mom I didn't want to interview at FIU? But he said he really had no interest, was very happy being on the UM staff. Went there, and he said 8 hours later, Pete Garcia, the president, had him convinced he could win a national championship here.
Well, and I bet his mom said, hey, she can make you great food every day if you want to come walk home, walk from practice to come and see me. That's a great story.
There are a lot of connections between the Hurricanes and FIU, and now they're going head-to-head in recruiting circles. Cristobal, longtime assistant coach, Tiger Clark. Bernard Clark was an outstanding linebacker.
He and I played the East-West Shrine game together, so I've known Tiger for a long time.
And Pete Garcia, who Melissa interviewed before the game, was the director of football operations for that tremendous run at UM. Randy Shannon now trying to bring it back where it was, but Cristobal was part. He blocked for Gino Toretta when he won a Heisman, and he laughs thinking about that Sugar Bowl when he went against Copeland and Curry in Alabama, beat his Miami team 34-13. He said, ouch, those guys were really good. Yeah. The referee's having a little problems communicating with the new stadium. And so now they've gone to the phone, and now they're back on the field now.
The ruling on the field is confirmed. The runner's forward progress was stopped before the ball came loose. Forward International is charged with their first team timeout.
And that's the other thing about review. You have to have indisputable evidence. And they did, I mean, click. Right here, he's going to be down. He stopped there, went down, ball comes out. Pretty clear to me, Doug. But once again, I think for Cristobal, they've had opportunities after the football. This is a chance for him to talk to his defense, maybe shore up a few things. Plancher should have scored on that had he not gotten hit or made a move.
Mike Ford in the game now at tailback for South Florida. The big hoss from Sarasota got hurt. High ankle sprain. Last carry of the first game. Spins off a tackler and a touchdown. Boy, he looked good on that one. Mike Ford, his first touchdown of the season. And he is a absolute load.
All I'd say was, what if Alabama had him in the stable of backs that they have now? Now, this is a run where you just have some athletic ability. He's been struggling with an ankle. Great spin move. Made three guys miss outside. Very good run by Mike Ford. That is why they're so high on him here. He's been hurt since the first game of the season, but he brings another dimension to the South Florida offense.
So the field goal, or the extra point now, attempt is good. It's 7-0 South Florida. Bonanni with the extra point. He was the young man who kicked that field goal in overtime to beat Kansas. The ground game just chewing up FIU. The Bulls on top. FIU 0. ESPNU College Football is presented by Citi. Whatever your story is, your Citi card can help write it, because Citi never sleeps. Boy, it's fun to be in South Florida, Miami, and right now South Florida from Tampa, the Big East, on top of Florida International from the Sun Belt, 7-0. A year ago, we were in Fort Lauderdale, Buck, as South Florida came across to play Florida Atlantic, another Sun Belt member.
You know, I just love the intensity of these rivalries. It's almost like you're watching their high school careers take place in front of you, the Broward, Dade County area, and what Howard Snellenberger says, the state of Miami.
A high, short kick. Tough to get a hold of that one. That's what they're trying to do, is contain T.Y. Hilton. First time that exciting youngster has touched the football.
Well, Doug, we're going to take a look at the touchdown. You're going to see Matt Garris on the end do his job perfectly well. Stop right there. You see all those defenders outside. There's no way Mike Ford should score this touchdown. But when he makes the spin move, everyone's outside, and they all miss. That, you can't have that. They were so intent on stopping him. The over-pursuit angle allowed Mike Ford a chance to score six.
Paul McCall again in at quarterback. You saw number four, T.Y. Hilton, in your screen. And Hilton, the first time he touched the ball in his FIU career, he returned a punt for a touchdown in Lawrence, Kansas. First pass attempt. And it is caught on the outside. That's Junior Mortiel, true freshman. 14-yard pickup.
Very good play call also, Doug. What they really did a good job of is working one way. T.Y. Hilton, you see him come back out also. They run a short side of the field or boundary
bootleg, which you don't see a whole lot. Usually you see it going to the wide side of the field. Good play call by Bill Legg. He's got ties to Purdue, so you're going to see some things of the Purdue bubble screens. You're going to see a lot of those things. They want to help the spread get going. They haven't scored any touchdowns by air with this offense yet.
Back to the ground. Getting hemmed up is Amon Ned. Coming up tonight on ESPNU. As always, lots of action. 25th-ranked Fresno State against Toledo. Then 11:30 Eastern is Tuskegee against Stillman, a battle in Alabama. It's college football primetime presented by Citi on ESPNU tonight. Both of these games also available on ESPNU HD. Lots of travel for a team like Florida International and Fresno State, who you'll see tonight. FIU third on that list for most miles that will be traveled this season. They are road warriors, these youngsters. It's the reverse coming up to make a terrific stop is Jerome Murphy. Boy, Murphy is so quick. Leading tackle, and you saw why right there.
Yeah, and the thing with this defense, they're so fast that you can't run plays sideline to sideline. I know what they're trying to do, but that was a great play by Jerome Murphy of getting inside. Doesn't get blocked right there by Greg Ellingson. Even if he is, the speed of the South Florida defense is just so fast.
Murphy is the young man who knocked Pat White out of the West Virginia game last year with that crushing tackle right in his thigh. Also forced a fumble of Steve Slayton in that West Virginia game a year ago. Under the gun and throwing it too hard to T.Y. Hilton was Paul McCall. Boy, that quarterback clock was ticking fast, and he threw it just a little too hard and just a little too early.
We don't say George Selvey's name a whole lot because they're blocking. Great first step. You remember James Worthy in basketball, how he had the great first step. George Selvey, look at that, off the ball. That was Bowie. But Selvey has it as well, but Selvey's always getting double teamed. They expect Bowie on the other side, who has a great first step as well, to make some plays.
Carlos Munera on to punt. Just got it off. Under the gun, that goes off the side of his foot. That'll be a short punt. It'll be excellent field position for the South Florida Bulls. We're talking about FIU, but South Florida has also come from some very humble beginnings. This is only their 12th season of organized football. And for the first 10 years, the Ponderosa was their home. That story is next. For South Florida, a beautiful campus, and they decided they wanted football, and that was the coach's office for the longest time. Jim Leavitt hired in 1995, and there he is dressed as a beef stud during the basketball season as he raised money for a friend of the program who was suffering from cancer. Completed pass to the outside. Grothy again. That was a nice throw to A.J. Love, 13 yards. And that's what a beef stud looks like if you're a young stud.
A young calf. That's a beef calf.
And Jim Leavitt, as we talked to him the other day, really has no desire to go anywhere else. Loves playing at Raymond James. Doesn't want to raise money for an on-campus stadium like they have at FIU. Very content. Has a new contract in his hand that virtually will keep him there for the rest of his career. Grothy with all day decides to hoof it. And the Bulls quarterback out of bounds. After picking up 6 yards.
Doug, so far the four interior linemen haven't provided any pressure for Florida International. And you talk about South Florida having what they have there at Raymond James. But right here, you can see no pressure. He can just sit back. He has Mike Ford open but decides not to. So they're almost like playing him, we're going to let you scramble a little bit and then come up and strike you. But that's giving him 6 or 7 yards.
Grothy now on second down. Back to Mike Ford. Ford, boy, he is a big-time back. Appears to be healthy. Quentin Newman tripped him up, but this kid, when you watch him, and as we've watched him on tape, oh, boy, he runs downhill.
We say he has fresh legs. He's been out for a couple of weeks. Just good blocking by the line. You see those white jerseys pushing back. But also some individual effort by Mike Ford. He has a great ability and a knack to get those extra yards after he's been hit.
Third and short. Back to the ground game. Another first down. Mike Ford. Mario Cristobal, as I said in the office yesterday, Buck, and talked to him, and he, an old offensive lineman himself, and he just kept bragging about this South Florida offensive line. He said, these kids, They're really good.
They've been tested, Doug, and we've seen them over the last 2 years. I got a chance a couple of years ago to watch them against Louisville, their coming out party. And I've watched a lot of these linemen like Mark Dial and Jake Griffin grow up, Mike Hooners. So it's interesting to watch how they're playing now. So much better even than when they were younger guys.
Mike Ford getting some carries, his third straight carry, this time over the right side. Scott Bryant on the stop for FIU.
The key with South Florida is how they finish. We've seen them over the last couple of years play well early on. But that's the one thing you ask Jim Leavitt, you talk to other coaches around there, how do you finish? And they haven't done that over the last couple of years. And that's what he talked about. We haven't won a Big East championship. We haven't done anything.
Second down for Grothy, who has all day and a wide open Jesse Hester. He'll never be more open than he was there in the middle of the field. 19-yard pickup.
Well, for all you folks that remember Jesse Hester Sr., that's Florida State. His young son Jesse Jr. is playing outstanding, and this is a great play. They like to get him over the middle of the field and then make him work up inside. That's his 13th consecutive game with a catch. They have so many different weapons. You can see the total yards is going to a lot of different people, a lot of different backs also, Doug.
That last drive was 99 yards, remember. This is very impressive as well, as they are just eating up FIU inside the tackles, Buck. I mean, this looks like men against boys.
The problem is you don't come away with points on the other turnover, and then you give up touchdowns. And your defense is on the field so long, so what happens? They start over-pursuing, missing tackles. Right there, Michael Dominguez thought he was in position, doesn't make the play, but when you're on the field this long, it's hot on that turf right now.
That's field turf, brand new. Mike Ford tripped himself up on the field turf. Cristobal on the sidelines, trying to get his troops revved up a bit. Cristobal wears that tie, Buck, and we were thinking and brainstorming. Howard Schnellenberger is old school and actually wears a blue blazer as well, but I can't think of another collegiate coach. Joe Paterno occasionally wears a tie, but that's old school right there.
That is old school, and the guys that he's admired and read about and looked to for guidance, that's what they did. He wanted to have a little class. He's trying to help this Florida international team come together.
They're 3-for-3 on third down conversions, and that gets batted down, but the flag comes down as well. Robert Mitchell thought he made a nice play, but I think his right hand was on the receiver, Buck. Let's see if he hooked him.
Well, Robert Mitchell is a stat stuffer. He has all the stats. He leads the team in tackles.
Holding, number 17 on the defense. Penalty is half the distance to the goal. First down.
One interception, one fumble recovery, one sack. But right here, he also has a penalty to go with those stats. I thought, you know, that didn't really look like one to me. He put his hand back there, his right hand. He didn't grab jersey. And usually when you grab cloth, they call it. Did a good job of coming around, I thought, Doug, and making the play.
Mitchell is very long. He has long arms. And some NFL scouts are looking at him. Young man from Melbourne, very active, has a pick already this season. Mike Ford runs into 1, 2, 3. Blue jerseys, 4 and 5 are standing around as well. The first quarter goes by very quickly as South Florida ate up most of the time. On the ground, 12th-ranked team in the country, flex their muscles. And they were four tough. Here comes FIU. September 20th, 2008. A day to remember. South Florida trying to make it a day to forget. Today's game on ESPN and ESPNU is brought to you on ESPN High Definition. To find out more, log on to ESPNU.com. What a day to be out on the ocean today. Our ESPNU College Football Primetime presented by Citi. Matt Grothy to the air and knocked out of bounds by Jeremiah Weatherspoon is Cedric Hill.
We talked about the versatility of Cedric Hill. He's just one of those guys that just does a very good job of making himself available in any situation you put him in.
Looking at the stat track, South Florida 12th in the country wearing their road white. Florida International playing their first ever game on their home field. wearing their blue. And South Florida will call timeout. It's third and goal from the 3-yard line. Let's go to Lowell Galindo and Mike Gottfried in the ESPNU studio. All right, Lowell, thank you. North Carolina, boy, they are looking very good. We did a couple of Carolina games a year ago, and Butch Davis told us he thought he was 2 years away. He may have it right now.
Well, remember, there was talk also about him potentially leaving. He said, I'm not going anywhere.
He's got some serious talent in Chapel Hill.
Man, does he? Definitely.
Maybe not the deepest team in the ACC, but those front guys, as long as they're healthy.
And what he wanted last year, Doug, was speed. Remember he talked about, let's get speed here again at North Carolina.
Jamar Taylor, lots of speed. The fake to Taylor, Grothy. Into the end zone, and that goes incomplete, looking for Cedric Hill.
And Hill's shaking up on that play. No, it's a good call. We talked about bootlegging, and Cedric Hill gets a chance to go to the middle of the field and work across it as a tight end and a quarterback. This is an area you know you usually get a chance. Hill just couldn't come up with it. Grothy felt pressure there by Scott Bryant, had a chance to get it out. Just couldn't, Cedric Hill couldn't come up with it.
20-yard field goal attempt. Nakam Barani boots it through. And it's 10-0 South Florida. Barani got the nod against Kansas. Jim Leavitt said it was just a hunch, and the hunch has paid dividends. An impressive start for the 12th-ranked team in the country, the South Florida Bulls from the Big East. They flexed their muscles and basically just steamrolled FIU in their inaugural game in their brand-new stadium. It's been impressive.
It really has, Doug, but the one area you have to look at for Florida International is their offense. Ranked 109th total offense in the NCAA. 178 yards per game. South Florida is going to get that probably by the half, and they usually do. So they need to get some offensive firepower going here at Florida International if they are going to have a chance.
Justin Tichy, a senior from Palmetto, Florida, handles the kickoff duties, and he boots it through the end zone. Let's join Lowell Galindo in the studio for a SportsCenter U in-game update. Lowell, thank you. Tennessee had an opportunity with it 17-0 down inside the 3-yard line and fumbled it away. And it appears their chances are out the window as well. Georgia at Arizona State tonight, the primetime game on ABC. Of course, he told you about Florida, LSU, Auburn tonight on ESPN. And Alabama clobbered Arkansas. Short completion for FIU.
You know, Doug, they need something on offense to get going. I mean, rushing the ball, they're only averaging 61 yards a game. And I keep talking about if they could get to that 5-yard per carry average, but that's almost like a hill and a mountain for them. They're only averaging this year 2.3 yards per carry. We talked to Bill Legg about it. He says statistics don't always give you the true indication, but I think in this case they do because they just cannot get anything going on the ground.
Second down, McCall. The shuttle pass goes nowhere to Julian Reams. Tyrone McKenzie comes up to hammer him.
And we see that from teams that don't do a very good job of running the draw. You go to the shuffle pass. But that's in the area right there where he's not running away from anybody. The defense can just come and get you right where you are. The South Florida defense is so fast. But I think the one key person they're missing this year is Moffitt. Ben Moffitt was a big playmaker for them. And as they get in the league play, let's see how well they'll continue to play. They played some really good games against UCF and Kansas. Let's see if they can continue that.
Wally Burnham on the sidelines, longtime defensive guru watching his defense. It appears that he gets a nice spot. That's an 8-yard pickup. It looks like it's going to be a first down, a rare first down for FIU.
Second one of the game for him, but I think when you look at that, that's the kind of thing they have to have. Paul McCall is a better athlete than you give him credit for. We think of Wayne Younger being the guy that can come in and be athletic. But right there, he saw, I have nobody open. Let me go get that first down. 10 for South Florida, 2 for Florida International on first down.
Paul McCall trying to generate something positive for FIU, keeps it himself, goes forward for a nice pickup.
Now, George Selby was so out of position on this, and McCall saw that and was able to get back around to the other side.
Lost his shoe on that one, Buck.
Yeah, top of your screen. Watch Selby come down, 95. He tries to stop and redirect. McCall sees that. That's the play you want to see. When Selby, you get it, let him go free. He doesn't go free so often that he's ready to go. And when he gets turned around and gets beat, he's been double and triple teamed this year, Doug. He wanted to get 20 sacks or more. It's going to be tough for him. But his off defensive coordinator, Wally Burnham, said he's playing his best football.
Just one sack on the season for the All-American, but he has been triple teamed all year. Back to the ground, and boy, Julian Reams, he took a shot, picks up four. That was a jolting hit as he hops back up, readjusts the chin strap.
Talk about a physical game, and you'll see it at real speed. If you want to play college football, you better be ready for shots like that, especially when you're playing in a Florida-type game. The speed or the feel, but also these players, there's some talking going on and some popping as well.
Terrell McClain, number 97, got his first start today. And Wally Burnham said he's finally stepped up his game. And there's Selby on the outside. And give big number 95 a sack. With a little help from his friend on the other side, but that was all 95.
Yeah, McCall may be hurt, though. Watch George Selby, one man blocking him, gets a chance, and watch over the top. Chris Robinson comes over and just pancakes him, but Selby, that quick release off the line, able to get by you so fast, you got to do a job blocking him. And I don't know if Paul McCall should be in the game. He looked like he took a shot, second sack on the season for George Selby.
He really got bent over like a pretzel. Back to the ground it goes, and Julian Reams. Another tackle by Chris Robinson. It's time for the Buck Stops here in West Miami, Buck.
Well, you talk about quick first step. You see him coming off the line, just getting the people before they even know he's there. Look at how quick he is. But also, this year he's put on 10 pounds, Doug, in muscle. So, boy, you can't push him around like he said last year. Sometimes late in the season, we did this game right here. Look how he redirects. Quick, high motor guy. Great work ethic by George Selby.
Quickness is his game. Quick like a cat. Paul has time and just overshoots his man, Alonzo Phillips. Jerome Murphy was all over Phillips. I like Murphy, though.
I do, too. And McCall is still not quite right from that hit. He's still limping when he runs off the field. Can't quite gather himself and throw the ball. But, Doug, you're right. This South Florida Bull defense, we've seen him over the last couple of years make plays. And Jerome Murphy, we just keep calling his name.
Carlos Munera, another punt. This time, a good punt from the junior. Fair catch at the 20, and that's where South Florida will start again. A 40-yard punt, no return. The Sun Belt Commissioner is next. The Bulls on top of FIU in the inaugural game at FIU Stadium, 10-0. Let's go down to the sidelines. Melissa Knowles with the Sun Belt Commissioner, Wright Waters. Melissa?
Commissioner Waters, what does the opening of this new stadium mean to the Sun Belt Conference?
Oh, it's huge, Melissa, because what it does is it demonstrates the confidence that the university and the university system has in athletics. And we're more than just a game. It's about leadership and teaching these wonderful things that are only available in athletics.
What other new additions can we expect in the future?
I think you'll see us try at this point in time, try to continue to get better and better at what we're doing. And we've got good members. We've got members that are dedicated to the right thing. And now we just have to get better at what we're doing.
Good luck, Commissioner. Thanks.
Thank you, Melissa.
Doug?
Thanks, Melissa. Good things happening in the Sun Belt and for South Florida. Grothy completes another pass to the outside. This to Ben Bushy. One of the few non-Floridians, young man from Mobile, Alabama.
He's been in the program for a while, Doug, and thought you'd see him more. He sneaks out to the left side. Grothy, once again, with all the time in the world. Bushy out there just making the catch, picking up 9 yards. The problem with the defense is now the defensive front is really not getting any pressure, so Mac Grothy can just sit back and take his time and find open receivers.
Grothy looks so quick after losing all that weight. Back to the ground it goes, Jamar Taylor. And you sense no gain there. That was a good stop by the FIU defense, especially up front. Armon Willis. But you sense that South Florida's going to bust along with here.
Yeah, you expect it. And you can see here the angle of the sun is right in their face. When I was on the field before, I couldn't even look back that way because it's right in your face. Once it goes down, it'll be better. Brouce is probably in, too, because Cedric Hill, the tight end, was hurt on that previous series.
Nothing fancy. Jamar Taylor bursts forward for another South Florida first down. Scott Bryant on the stop for the Golden Panthers. Jamar Taylor and Mike Ford are both sophomores. And Ford is the power back, Taylor the speed guy. And that's a great 1-2 punch, but then they have three or four others.
Well, Mo Plancher says, hey, put me in the mix. Benjamin Williams says, hey, I want to play some. And then Sean Cannon has two rushes on the season. So they have a plethora of backs.
See what they do on first down. Grothy to a wide open Marcus Edwards on the right side. Remember, all season long, ESPNU is your source for college football information. Monday, 7 Eastern, watch Lo Galindo, Mike Gottfried, and Tom Luganville. It's Inside the Polls, presented by 76. Find out who's overrated, who's underrated. Then Tuesday, 1 Eastern, Lo hosts Coach's Spotlight, presented by Liberty Mutual. Find out how all the teams are doing from their head coach, their weekly press conference. And my partner, Charles Arbuckle, a big part of that show on Tuesday.
We did 23 coaches this past week.
Hey, I watch in amazement, and I'm one of those crazy people that love to hear the coaches' press conferences, and it helps me as I prepare for a game. Grothy again showing off that quickness. Thought about sliding, then thought about maybe breaking a bigger one, a 16-yard pickup into FIU territory. Weatherspoon on the stop for FIU.
This is where he's even better. You know, you want him to use his legs, but now he has more speed and quickness. And then he was thinking, let me get down. No, I don't know. The defense there, the pressure up front. He sees the opening. They're playing man, so he knows there's no one to account for him and just does a very good job of finding those openings.
That ball could have gotten knocked away.
Oh, yeah.
You're going to run it. You need to tuck it. You need to do the buck tuck. Mike Ford over the right side. I know Ford's excited about playing again. Was disappointed with that high ankle sprain. Working his way through rehab. Again, we're live in Miami, Florida. West Miami, to be exact. It's the first game ever in the new FIU Stadium. 12th-ranked South Florida against FIU. Doug Bell alongside former UCLA Bruin, Charles Arbuckle, and Melissa Knowles down on the sidelines. South Florida dominating this game. Look at the total yards. I mean, that's not even funny. The flip to the outside. It's Torres Johnson and Anthony Gator again rushing up to make the stop.
Very good play by Anthony Gator, and also poor blocking by Torres Johnson's guys. They didn't do a very good job of picking up in that diamond set. You're going to see here, they're setting up the screen outside. There's three receivers out front. None of them got their blocks. Brouce is the tight end. That's usually where Cedric Hill plays when he's healthy. Didn't get his block. Anthony Gator with a nice play on that screen.
Carlton Mitchell in for USF. Lower part of your screen. Grothy looks at him all the way and finally gets pushed out of the pocket. And gets thrown for another loss. So FIU's defense gets pesky. Scott Bryant was in there.
Good sack by their defense also. But it took them a while, once again, Doug, to get there. Grothy has time. Good pass pro initially, but way too much time. And then he's able to move around, and they're finally able to bring him down. You know, that's the one thing about FIU. They must put pressure on Grothy. Good sack there by James Jones.
Anthony Gator is down back at the 25. As the training crew runs out along with Coach Cristobal to check him. Cristobal, he told us, you know, he's offering these kids an opportunity for something special. You know, you come in, you're going to play right away.
Yeah.
And as we build the new stadium, and every year we're going to add to the stadium and add to our facilities, you're going to be a part of something we're growing here.
T.Y. Hilton is a prime example of that. He was recruited by a lot of people, even though he's a little bit undersized. He's an exciting player, both two-way guy, returner and a receiver. But what they like about him is that he wanted to come here to help build this program.
Delbert Alvarado into booted away for South Florida, and Jeremy Dickens is deep for the Golden Panthers, and he's going to let this one bounce. And South Florida will let this roll inside the 10-yard line, and they down it at the 9. So FIU struggling already now at the 9-yard line. The 12th-ranked South Florida Bulls on top of Florida International, 10-0, 5:06 to play. Allstate presents Bergwood On Location, and today we look at the new beginnings, the FIU Stadium. Exciting stuff here on this beautiful campus. And for the first time, there was tailgating outside the new digs. And how about the head coach wearing a tie? Not many people do that. Tailgate with Bergwood at bergwood.net. Bergwood is all over the place, checking out all the new stadiums around the country, all the traditions, and they're starting a tradition here at FIU. McCall throws it out of bounds and takes a good pop by Craig Marshall. And how about that tie? He said it started last year before they played Penn State. Hey, I've always admired guys like Shim Beckler and Bear Bryant, Joe Paterno, so it hit me out of respect, a show of class, and it kind of stuck.
Well, you know, Doug, we talked about it earlier. He's trying to build something here, you know, trying to have guys hold on to some kind of tradition. And I think that's the one thing that he wanted to give the game. I mean, giving him so much. The thing they need now is getting more recruits to fill the stadium, more guys that can help them make big plays, especially on offense.
Timeout by Paul McCall as he comes to the sidelines. Again, Bill Legg is the offensive coordinator at FIU. He's been at Purdue, or had been at Purdue, the last 5 years, and when he did not get the head coaching job, he left.
Yep.
And as Mario Cristobal told us, hey, it was a blessing. He shows up looking for a job, and he was the experience we needed on the offensive side, and obviously it's going to take some time.
It is, and now they need players to make the plays that you want to see them make. And I think that's the one area. He has two quarterbacks. What did he say? If he can morph them into one body and make McCall and Younger the same guy, that he likes the intangibles about him. You can see him there in the huddle talking to his guys. He just doesn't have a whole lot.
Yeah, that's Bill Legg there off to the left, the old offensive lineman from West Virginia. Let's go down to the sidelines and listen all.
You guys saw Anthony Gator go down a couple plays ago. He came over to the sideline and he took a knee. They were giving him water. And what the trainers told me is that he's just dehydrated. It is hot out here, guys. It is so hot that some of the fans who painted their bodies may be reconsidering because it's melting.
Well, it's South Florida.
Yeah, it is. Hey, and Doug, you know, let's think about Bill Legg. He came from Purdue, and before Purdue, he was with West Virginia, had Mark Bulger. So he has seen some talent over his years, and that's what they need here at Florida International.
Played for Hall of Famer Don Nealon at West Virginia. Back to the ground and going nowhere. Boy, that's some gang tackling. Look at all the white jerseys around the football. Can't tell you who made that tackle. There's too many of them.
And I'm still worried about McCall. I mean, he's still limping around, and that's where I'm surprised we haven't seen Wayne Younger, who actually, in percentages, has a better passing percentage than Paul McCall. Better legs. So neither guy has really stepped up. You're going to see the shot that he took from George Selvey. Actually, this was just recently, but even before this, that was by Craig Marshall. Craig Marshall rushing, knocking. They're really hitting them every single chance they get, Doug.
He's going to be in that ice bath probably tonight, certainly tomorrow. There's a completed pass. We'll come up short. There'll be 1 out of 4 now in third down conversions. A completed pass to Eric Kirchenberg is tight end. Carlton Williams on the stop for USF. So another punting situation for the Panthers.
You know, another one of those outer staters, Carlton Williams out of Valdosta, Georgia. We've called his name a lot over the years as a strong safety position. The real key with Florida International is getting something. Now defensively, they must make plays because they've been on that field so long.
Manera, low liner of a punt, fielded at the 49. By Marcus Edwards. He dodges a few bullets and then just keeps going and gets it up to the 37-yard line. That was a 40-yard punt and a 16-yard return. ESPNU.com is your gateway to all college sports content from ESPN. Check out all the latest video and audio highlights, podcasts, live streaming games. Log on to ESPNU.com today. Coming up to half, Lowell Galindo, Coach Gottfried. Love to hear from the coach. His insight, rocky times in Knoxville. Oh, boy, the Boo Birds are out for Phil Fulmer. ECU's BCS hopes have been dashed. And Pryor's first career start at Ohio State brought back memories of Vince Young. Looks a lot like him, doesn't he?
Yeah, he does. He plays just like VY.
And Troy, another Sun Belt school, playing in Ohio State today. Gain of two there for South Florida. They've been very conservative today. Running in between the tackles, safe pass plays, Grothy scrambling a bit. Of course, Greg Gregory described to us, his offense is unpredictable. As you look at the top quarterbacks, does Grothy belong in that elite company?
I think he does. I think the one thing with Grothy, if he can continue with the interception, the touchdown ratio being where it is on his career, 36 touchdowns, 30 interceptions this year, better ball security.
Movement by the right and left tackle. I'm not sure who'll get nabbed for that. Sam Bradford, though, in my mind,
he is tough.
He's the leading candidate for the Heisman right now, with Sanchez at USC probably too.
Julio Iglesias, Jerome Gresham, the receivers he has. Chase Daniel, I really like him. But I think Mark Sanchez out at USC because of those weapons that he has and the defense that they have at USC.
Grothy has, he can run a mile, and he decides to. He's showing off that quickness, and he's going to run out of bounds without. That was a smart play. No need to take a hit. Gets it up to the 26-yard line. He just looks so much quicker. Now, he was quick last year.
Yeah.
Towards the end of the year, he got nicked up. But he's in the best shape of his life right now.
But he also is poised and knows how to slow the game down. Watch the move that he makes right here. He has the ball up, and then he just makes the move on Robert Mitchell. And it's a subtle thing with him. But he keeps the ball up and allows it to happen like that. He doesn't average a lot because a lot of those are sacks. He loses yards there. But still, one touchdown, 103 yards on the season. But what I like about him is just the little subtle moves that he makes gets people out of position.
Plancher in the backfield, two tight ends. Plancher moves forward, just keeps those legs churning. Positive yards, picks up five.
That's an ugly 5 yards by Plancher, but he does that. Plancher just, he keeps the feet moving. He's just moving those feet constantly. The stable of backs, I think, too. This is a game for them, which I think makes sense, Doug. If you can get a lead and then also let all your guys play in the backfield, they need to have this later in the season. They need production out of their running game as well as their passing away from Matt Grothy.
And second down, Grothy with time to the outside. That's Hester. Tripped himself up. Got the first down.
And this is a good play again. Look at the time. Matt Grothy looks inside, then comes outside. You have Robert Mitchell trying to cover. Jesse Hester just stumbles and falls. With the new turf, what they have to do is slick out there. You got to start watering it to get that rubber that's on the top down. Sometimes you'll run and you'll see guys slip down.
Timeout, FIU.
That is our last time out of the half.
And we have a Panther growl coming from the loudspeaker. All sorts of new stuff here at FIU Stadium. As you look at Jim Leavitt. And Leavitt, here's a guy who's had just an incredible run here at South Florida. But as he told us, hey, we really haven't accomplished anything yet. I mean, people really give us more credit than I think we deserve.
Well, and I think the people will realize, if you think of South Florida and where they've been, they have. Everybody now knows them. It's like East Carolina. Everybody's like, oh, well, East Carolina, they've been around for a while, but now people know that they can come up and play you. This is how South Florida is.
South Florida, if you look at their future schedules, the Florida Gators, Notre Dame, 96 players on the roster from the state, FIU 83. And you see the recruiting budget for South Florida, it's the lowest in the BCS, but the coach told us they are branching out, trying to recruit more nationally. He's happy what he's done in competing against the big three in the state.
Yes.
Speaking of the Gators, the Hurricanes, and Seminoles, they've gotten their share here the last two or three years.
They really have, and he says that's been the key for him, them getting even more people. It doesn't hurt them being in the Big East and the exposure that they've gotten. He has to thank Miami, Virginia Tech, and those schools, especially Miami, in their own area, to move out of the Big East and allow them a spot there.
First and 10, back to Mo Plancher, cuts back. Hard to bring down. Jim Leavitt talking about recruiting told us they were landing some of the kids, we're doing a little bit better, but we're still battling that big thing called tradition.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, you look at those two schools, Miami and Florida State. Where did they go? They left the, you know, they're in the Atlantic Coast Conference. So that allows them to go in the Big East now with some real powerhouse teams, at least in the Big East last year. They're struggling this year. See Matt Grothy with the quick snap.
Flag down. And he throws it away. FIU, I think as we counted the players, I think they have 12 men on the field, Buck.
Looks like it.
We'll check it.
Yep.
They're trying to get a player off. I'm not sure he got off before the snap, and he did not.
Second down.
So it'll replay second down. Little cross up there on the coaching staff. I mean, I'm not blaming on the new stadium, but the coaches are on top of the press. Well, there really is no press box. They have the suites built.
Yeah.
So the players are on top. They were working out things with the communication between the sidelines and up top earlier.
The stadium is still a whip. Even though yeah. It's a work in progress, but it is nice so far.
Rothy into the end zone, and that was almost picked off by Anthony Gator, who's back on the field after leaving with cramps earlier.
And Matt Grothy was trying to throw that ball away, but Quentin Newman was bearing down on him. The senior out of Cocoa, Florida. Gator with a nice effort on the tail end. And on the ball, he tried to get rid of it, but didn't throw far enough. And Gator, look at this. Going through the sign, your name here. Gator. Anthony Gator's my name.
Probably should have had that one. You don't want those opportunities to go away against the 12th ranked team in the country. They'll make you pay. Grothy looking all the way left on one guy. And threw it off the helmet of A.J. Love. Boy, he locked on Love. That's the one thing about Grothy, and we've watched a lot of tape, doesn't go through those progressions. He locks on a guy.
Yeah, and that's what he's improved on. But at certain times, Doug, you're exactly right. If the play is going a certain place, watch his eyes. They stay right there. They don't move. And there's one, two, three defenders in that area. Not a good area to throw the football. I'm sure someone else is open. If three defenders are covering, somebody's open somewhere else.
So South Florida will decide on the field goal. Grant Gregory. Is in there now. He'll be the holder. And Buck, what do you think of this new era, new stadium here in Miami?
I like it. I like it. This is a nice university. When we drove over, the building's there. But I like what they're doing here, putting some finishing touches on it and really doing everything here.
Now, they have 16 luxury boxes. We're at the one in the middle. 15 have been sold. This will not be sold. They're saving for the person who puts their name on the stadium. And for the time being, we're using this as our broadcast position.
We're out with the fans. Great way to call a game.
At halftime, we'll be in there on the leather couch watching the flat screen. We'll be watching Lowell Galindo and Coach Godfrey do their halftime show. 26 yards. And a flag is down to the play. He missed it. Bonanni with a miss. And they ran into the kicker, FIU. So that will be a first down with just 10 seconds to go. And Bonanni is hurt. He's down in the green. Boy, they really ran into him.
Well, you can't give up opportunities like this. You have a chance here. But looking at the replay, he barely touched him, Doug. Look, watch the, I mean, he just flies to try to go get the ball. He doesn't even really touch him. Desiree Johnson, who comes from the side to try to get the block. I mean, he barely touched him. Now, that's a great acting job. I mean, it looked like he didn't even really come close to touching maybe his foot.
So Jim Leavitt now, the spot, they move that up just outside the 4-yard line. So South Florida uses a timeout. It'll be fourth down at about a half a yard for the first. There's 10 seconds to go. Again, as we broadcast here, the first ever broadcast from a brand new stadium, FIU Stadium. The first phase, what we're in right now, seats 18,000. There's 1,400 club seats. Those are in front of us. We told you about the 19 suites. And the Panther Club is on the first floor, and it was packed with Panther supporters earlier today. Phase two will take place over the next 3 years. The new field house, which will be in the end zone, and it'll include a huge weight room, 13,000 square feet. And you see where that open space is. That's where the coaches' offices will open out. They'll each have their own individual patio, which will be great for recruiting.
Oh, yeah.
And then the weight room, Pete Garcia and Mario Cristobal, they wanted one bigger than the U. The U built one over 10,000 square feet, so they said, by golly, 13. We're going to have 13,000.
And they're going to put that in. That'll be closing as well. And I think they'll have another big screen on the other end where the coaches' offices will be. If you look up, they have the structure kind of going up at the top right there, those steel beams that are reaching up. Looks like it'll be the perfect place for another big screen.
And Wright Waters, the Sun Belt commissioner, is so excited about this. Florida Atlantic has a stadium in the works. Troy has a wonderful facility. The Sun Belt, and now with more bowl tie-ins, yeah. Wright Waters has worked very hard in that area. Things are looking up for this Sun Belt Conference. It has some impressive wins already this year.
It really does, and that's what you want to look at. And they're playing like today. Troy played Ohio State tough, real tough.
Bonani shook off that injury. I think you're right, Buck. I think maybe a little Academy Award acting on that one. A 21-yard field goal attempt now for the young man. The hero a week ago, and it's blocked. FIU blocks it. Robert Mitchell got in there.
The field goal attempt
to block that ball. 1 second to go on the clock. That gets this crowd revved up.
Really does. And Doug, I was just thinking right when this play happened, that's where they had angle the last time. And instead of Johnson coming off the end, Robert Mitchell does. And he does a great job of laying out, going to get the football.
And again, we talked about Mitchell earlier, NFL scouts. Look at this guy. Look at how quick he is. Look at how long he is.
Yeah, exactly. And they look for players like him. If he gets in the camp, it can show that he can cover. But special teams is where a guy like Robert Mitchell, if he doesn't get drafted or drafted later, can make a mark. You're always looking for guys like him. That's why Steve Tasker was a gunner. I mean, he was a great special teams guy and played forever because of that ability. Blocking kicks, doing the dirty work. Nobody wants to do that. Well, good job, Robert Mitchell. I get excited about those guys.
I was
one of them. I love them.
So that's the end of the first half. The first half ever played in the new FIU Stadium. Jim Leavitt not happy, although his team is up 10-0. Now let's join Lo Galindo with SportsCenter U. Welcome back to ESPNU College Football Primetime, presented by Citi. It's South Florida on top of Florida International, 10-0. Hi, folks. Doug Bell, Charles Arbuckle. Welcome to FIU Stadium. The first time they've ever played in this brand new stadium. FIU's played inspired football. Offensively, they continue to struggle. South Florida, a great first quarter, Buck. Slow down second quarter.
Yeah, Doug, and I think the real key, Florida International's defense has played really well. The problem is their offense hasn't given them anything.
Yeah.
South Florida, on the other hand, they're playing a methodical game, just trying to march the ball down the field. And the real key for them is just making plays on the ground. You can see Mike Ford getting outside, coming back inside for a touchdown. A real key play for them. And then George Selby getting his second sack on the year. And that's where John McCall, the quarterback, got hurt. And you can see here the block field goal. Another good play by Robert Mitchell.
And looking at the numbers, really domination by South Florida, 218 total yards to 40. First downs, a whopping lead for USF.
Well, you kind of expect this when you look at this South Florida International team. They're 119th ranked total offense in the NCAA. They have to find a way to score some points, make some positive gains. And if they can't do that, their defense is going to just wear out.
Justin Tichy will kick off for South Florida. His last kickoff went to the end zone, and now he's 2 for 2. He's got a heck of a leg.
The kickoff goes through the end zone.
And so FIU will start from the 20-yard line, and Paul McCall went the distance. And we're waiting to see Wayne Younger. Perhaps the quarterback change will generate a spark FIU needs.
You're looking for something, Doug. I mean, this offense and the defense is wishing for it. They'll say, man, we need some help anywhere. And if it's not going to be Wayne Younger, then Paul McCall has to find a way to march his guys down the field, the junior out of Hollywood, Florida.
Took a couple of nice shots in the first half, wearing that rib protection. And I guess he knew what was coming. Selby let him out of his grasp. And that's just a horse collar. Loses his helmet. Nate Allen on the stop. Hey, the buck stops right here at FIU. Buck.
Well, you got to talk about FIU. Big time hits right there. That's what you need to have. Jeremiah Weatherspoon is one of them. And then also just talented defensive flying around. They haven't put pressure on Grothy except for a couple of plays. And here's one as well, making him move and not feel comfortable. That's why the score is 10-0. And then also a great block by Robert Mitchell. Their defense is having to keep them in the ball game. And their plays and special teams, offensively, they've really, really struggled.
Ula Mataveo, the left tackle for FIU, is down on the turf. Up at the 27. And it appears he perhaps took a chop from behind, so they're examining his knee. And again, Mario Cristobal out on the field with his injured player, as he always does.
And he wasn't even supposed to play this year, really. I mean, he came in spring, a junior college transfer, and had to play right away.
So they're checking on Mataveo. You know, this is the first game at FIU Stadium, and we should mention for South Florida, Buck, tickets for today's game. Each college in Division I is allowed one premium game where you can raise the ticket prices a little bit. For FIU, this is the one. This is their inaugural game. $51 per ticket for South Florida, and that's $3 more than a year ago when they went to Auburn. They had to pay $48 for a ticket. Of course, that's the Southeastern Conference. But that's a premium price for this game.
That is.
They're showing their support.
Yeah. Well, the Bulls fans, they travel very well. They'll come and watch the South Florida team, and they've been accustomed to some winning ways here in the last couple of years. Once again, not quite over the hump from Jim Leavitt's perspective of getting to the Big East championship and winning that title.
They have respect for Florida International, regardless of the one loss record. They are Florida kids, and Jim Leavitt knows that. He says, I expect lots of energy from them. They're Florida kids. They'll rise up, play us hard, just like FAU did a year ago. And that's what we've seen today.
Yeah, and we did that game. We talked about it in depth with him, about Florida kids. All, you know, they have the understanding of how they play and how they are going to play against each other.
As you look at Jim Leavitt, the student section, which is full behind him, eventually that'll be the FIU student section as they continue to build onto this stadium, but they have the biggest student section in the Big East at Raymond James Stadium, 12,501 students. I mean, that's a big chunk.
That's a lot of people.
And they come in full force. Last week at Kansas, some got a little rambunctious, said some things they shouldn't have said. It really infuriated some of the Kansas supporters, and Jim Leavitt and other people at South Florida have urged the students, hey, as we build this tradition, let's calm down. Not everybody, just a few that made some bad choices.
And it sounded like some of the few were even older, more mature people. It wasn't always the students. And I think that's where Matt Grothy came out and spoke against the Jim Leavitt and some of the other players, saying, we don't need that. We need to show some class against people that come in and play us.
You see Leavitt's shirt has turned a different color, a darker shade of green, as the coach worked up that lather about 4:30 this afternoon. To the ground it goes. Best run of the day by Julian Reams. That's a 10-yard pickup. I mean, that's the biggest run of the year for FIU's running backs.
And, Doug, I'll tell you, what else is nice about this, see Jared Bowie trying to get over there and everybody out of position, so to speak, for the South Florida team. What this does, Florida International is only down by 10 points. If they can get 3 points and score a touchdown, they're right back in the ball game.
McCall from the gun back to Reams. Nope, loses the exchange. Was trying to pull that out of Reams, but it actually brushed against him, so that's a loss of two. You know, when you think of Bill Legg, he's on the sidelines, and he's big. Former offensive lineman, can't miss him. When you think of Purdue Buck, you think a lot of screens.
Yes.
A lot of bubble screens, every kind of screen, high screens, double slip screens. Haven't seen a lot of that from FIU.
No, we really haven't. I mean, we've seen more of the zone read play from them with the quarterback in the back, but not a lot of screens.
They're trying to implement that. There's the fake. That's what they were trying to do the last time. Same play call. Nice pass to Greg Ellingson. Positive play. That's a 10-yard pickup. Following that loss of two, it'll bring up third down and 2.5.
Now, these are the kind of plays here where you have to come up with first down. In the first half, they did a horrible job. Good job right there by McCall of throwing it low and away. If the receiver doesn't catch it, Ellingson, it's an incomplete pass. Good throw by McCall with the hurt leg that he's playing with.
1 out of 5, third down conversions for these FIU Golden Panthers. Reams looking for a block, and he runs right into Jarrett Bowie. I mean, that was helmet to helmet. That was a pop.
Too much dancing by Reams also. When you have that outside rusher coming in and Jarrett Bowie, you got to make one decisive cut. Watch how many moves he makes. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now, this defense is way too fast for Bowie and Selby, both ends coming to hit you. At that point, Reams has to just turn the ball up the field and go get some positive yards. See, his coach is probably telling him, can't dance. See, he's telling him right there, you can't dance. Go up in there. And that's where you get that first down. The leg is offensive lineman. He's up in his face. The offensive lineman get upset when they don't get a first down.
He played at West Virginia for Don Nealon.
His first recruit, right?
Yeah.
The first initial recruit.
And was actually drafted in the USFL by the Birmingham Stallions. Last year, it all started with a win at Auburn. Biggest win, perhaps, in the program's history. And then North Carolina, they were ranked. And they clobbered North Carolina at home. The nation started taking notice. And then West Virginia on a Thursday night. Buck, you and I were working a Saturday game. We watched it. Ben Moffitt and company, number 2 in the country. Oh, man. Could they go to a BCS Bowl? And then Rutgers, the first of 3 straight close losses in the Big East.
And we saw them a couple weeks before this when they played Florida Atlantic. And that's when we kind of said, hey, are they for real? They got exposed late in the season. This is what they need to do is close seasons out. Play better later in the season.
Marcus Edwards decided not to field that punt. And FIU will down it at the 5.5-yard line. A 49-yard punt, no return. Jim Leavitt, no smile today. South Florida trying to get something going here in the third quarter, leading 10-0. Again, welcome to FIU Stadium. Doug Bell, Charles Arbuckle, and Melissa Knowles. And Melissa, we're standing outside one of the premier suites. Premier place, isn't it?
You know what? It's really a nice view out here, but I want to check out inside.
Go inside.
I'm going to go in here.
Show it off.
Check it out in
that
here.
Flat screen is awesome.
Man.
It is.
Not only is the flat screen awesome, but let me tell you what else is awesome. The air conditioning. I told you about how hot it was down there. It is cool up here. Can I just stay right here? Oh, it feels so good in here, guys.
Hey, you look good inside there with that FSU logo on the back. That's a brand new logo, by the way, they unveiled just this season. To the ground it goes. Mike Ford continues to carry. Let's go back inside one of the 16 premier suites here at FIU Stadium. Melissa?
That's right. You know, this room doesn't even have an owner yet, so this could be yours. You could also get one of these great sandwiches they have in here. I'm actually going to take a bite. They got great food, too.
You always eat.
This could be your spot, guys.
That is our spot. As soon as the game's over, we're in there. We're going to enjoy it. It is nice, and the plans they have are spectacular. Let's join Lo Galindo now in the studio for SportsCenter U in-game update. All right, look out for Utah. Somebody is going to steal one of those BCS Bowl berths.
Yeah,
maybe
yeah.
A Utah, maybe a Boise, maybe a BYU. East Carolina got bumped off today. Didn't shock me at NC State. Looking for Jesse Hester.
And after struggling last week against Tulane, one of those situations too. Third and short. You know, South Florida, it's funny to watch them because you said it earlier. They're just not really the high-powered offense that we thought we'd see. Some of that has to do with Florida International, making plays when they have to.
think he's going to get stopped. He is. He is short of the first down.
See, the defensive speed for Florida International impressed me. It jumped right off when I watched them play Iowa and Kansas. Even though they struggled offensively and got beat really badly, this is not the same Florida International team from a couple of years ago. Their only issue, if they don't get T.Y. Hilton to come back with a long punt return, their offense just doesn't give them any opportunities.
Alvarado back to punt. Booms one high into the sky. T.Y. Hilton backs up and lets that go out of bounds. At the 47, a 39-yard boot, no return. FIU trying to get some momentum on the offensive side. Today's college football game on ESPNU is presented in high definition. And coming up tonight on the U, first at 8:15 Eastern, it's Fresno State. Bulldogs, number 25 in the country, taking on Toledo. And then 11:30 Eastern, it's Tuskegee against Stillman. College football primetime presented by City on ESPNU. FIU goes to the air, incomplete. Greg Ellingson was out there, but the pass was too high and he wasn't open.
Yeah, well, I like the fact that they are challenging. I mean, we saw so many underneath things. And Bill Legg said it best. He said, we just need to keep working. We're not playing at the highest level we need to. Guys have been nicked up. We haven't seen much out of Junior Mertil, who's a freshman, as well as T.Y. Hilton. He says, when we really get these guys acclimated and expand their playbook, they're going to really be special.
McCall has gone all the way. We thought we would see Wayne Younger. It's still plenty of time, but it appears McCall has settled in. Keeps himself, and that didn't fool anybody. Nice stop there by Danny Verpale. We are live in Miami, Florida, home of the FIU Golden Panthers. Brand new stadium, first game ever played here. It's South Florida, 12th ranked from the Big East. Doug Bell alongside Charles Arbuckle and Melissa Knowles. Hope you're enjoying our broadcast. South Florida has dominated as far as the statistics, but it's only 10-0 on the scoreboard.
Yeah, we keep saying it. If Florida International can get something going offensively, they'll be right back in the game.
South Florida, after they beat West Virginia a year ago, did not play particularly well in beating Florida Atlantic. That'll be a fourth down situation as they pick up three and perhaps another letdown today after the scintillating win against Kansas.
Great game against Kansas. But right there, that was a prime example of Florida International. You throw a two-yard route, there's no chance for you to get a first down. But South Florida, on the other hand, two big games back-to-back. The Central Florida game, another barn burner for them. Their last against Central Florida. And now they have got to come back and play a rivalry type of game again.
Manera has been busy. Theo Wilson gets chopped down immediately. 36 yards on the punt and just three on the return.
The punt was returned by number
nice play by Alonzo Phillips.
Mario Cristobal in his third season here of building this program at Florida International in his hometown of Miami. And as we do every week here, it's the coach's crib inside the office, a new coach, and there's the shovel that broke the ground right here at the stadium.
They don't ever tell you guys to get out?
Never.
You don't have to go home, but you got to get the heck out of here?
No. And look at the books.
I like that.
There's his diploma from the U, and the last game ever played at the Orange Bowl. A year ago, they played FAU, and then it was torn down right after. And the blitz on the outside. Robert Mitchell's had a big game.
You know, Paul Galliano said, hey, look, we're going to look at film. I was at Rutgers before. I know how to play these South Florida Bull teams. The real key is they're coming with pressure where Matt Grothy isn't expecting it. And that's why they're struggling defensively, offensively, for South Florida. Look at the excitement by the defense and Cristobal. I said earlier, if they can make a play in special teams or a turnover, pick six, something like that on offense, this game changes right away.
Grothy wearing that shield will keep it himself. Nowhere to go, and he gets wrestled down by Quentin Newman, the former walk-on. who has been a pleasant surprise for this FIU defense, and he's revved up. There has been a shift of momentum now.
Oh, it has been. But, you know, when you talk to Galliano, he said, look, we watch the Cincy film. We watch Oregon, Rutgers, FAU, our game last year. We got to figure out a way to make Brophy feel uncomfortable.
Is experiencing a bit of a bother right now as he bounces that one. That is incomplete. Looking for Dontavia Bogan. Bogan known for making the difficult grabs, but that was in the turf.
Now, I'll tell you this. If you kick it to T.Y. Hilton, you better have good coverage. This kid can really fly.
T.Y. has not touched the ball on this Saturday afternoon in the inaugural game in FIU Stadium. See, the crowd's getting revved up. Let's look at Delbert Alvarado. That unusual punt formation. That's a booming kick. It sends T.Y. Hilton back to the 32. His first touch. Dodges the first tackler and then runs into a stone wall. That was a good shot by Corey Grissom. 54-yard punt, four on the return. That'll wake up the freshman, huh?
And Chris Robinson cleaned it up very well.
Hello, welcome to D1 Football. They're revved up at FIU Stadium. They'd like their team to score and really make it interesting. It's up to the offense now. Doug Bell and Charles Arbuckle back here in West Miami. Julian Reams has been the workhorse tonight for FIU. Let's go to the buck stops here.
Well, what you have to have is great play and pressure. You're going to pressure Matt Grothy. You better come from all sides. Great job there by Robert Mitchell. And then also, again, whenever he runs, you have a spy usually, but everybody has to rally to Matt Grothy. Mario Cristobal has to be happy with his defense and special teams, not so much with his offense.
Getting it away quickly, and it's caught. Boy, he bobbled that around a little bit. Frierson almost dropped it, but and there's a USF player down, and we'll check that.
I think they hit each other. You see Brouce Ross Mompremier, 53. And then Carlton Williams, it looks like the other player.
Yeah, we will check that. Carlton Williams and Brouce Mompremier are down, and Premier got hit right in the neck area.
Yeah.
Sometimes you get that stinger, and it really shocks you, but we don't want to guess what it is. We will check both players.
A double catch there, and then he went down immediately, Brouce Mompremier. Carlton Williams. Hope he's all right.
Both players are still laying down on the ground as the medical team taking a look at those two young men. Mompremier, a senior from Miami, was excited about coming here and playing. That's a good sign as he moves. His right arm and his feet are also moving. And the crowd in the end zone saying some things perhaps they shouldn't as the two young men are being looked at. And there he is sitting up. That's a good sign. That's Mompremier sitting up. Actually, that Mompremier is still down.
Carlton
Williams. Williams being helped off the field. And he is moving gingerly to the sidelines. It is a beautiful evening here. Again, West Miami, we're close to Coral Gables, where the University of Miami is located. And if you're familiar at all with the Miami area, we're not too far from Doral, where the wonderful golf course is located, and they play the big World Golf Championship event there. It's just about 10 minutes or so from where we are. And this campus at FIU, just like the one in Tampa at South Florida, it's sprawling. There's a lot of acreage.
Yeah.
And there's a ton of students, and it's beautiful. It really is.
It really is.
I've been very impressed with our stay here in South Florida. As you talk to Cristobal, who is building his program virtually from scratch. Don Strock, the great quarterback from the Miami Dolphins, and Virginia Tech was the original coach. And they ran into a few problems along the way with the NCAA. And when they made the coaching change, now Cristobal trying to rebuild it as we look at the top 25. And there you see Georgia will play later tonight on ABC. Kirk Herbstreit was on this morning college game day in Auburn, Alabama, and takes the private jet, the ESPN jet, out to Tempe, Arizona, where Georgia will take on Arizona State tonight. And Auburn and LSU, 6-10, play tonight on ESPN.
I think Georgia will do well out there in Arizona, but the one thing, and it's been mentioned, and I thought about it earlier this week, but it comes more to fruition. It's very hot, even at 7, 8 o'clock at night. And then you can see some of the other folks, South Florida, number 12, Ohio State, that struggled today a little bit against Troy.
Mm-hmm. Wake Forest at Tallahassee, that's ESPN2 this evening. A huge game as Wake Forest tries for the hat trick, 3 in a row against Florida State. You know, you look at South Florida as we look at the Final Five, and Fresno State on ESPNU later tonight. And South Florida, in my mind, obviously today, Florida kids against Florida kids, one of these cross-state rivalries. Certainly the FIU kids just so fired up to play South Florida. But I think the Bulls, I know Kirk Herbstreit said it, and I think you said it also, I think they're the favorites, in my mind, to win the Big East.
Oh, I agree. I think they really are. Brouce Mompremier is still down. They're trying to get, I think, the EMT out.
Yeah, they are now. Yeah. They will come out and they will put the collar on him. And they will lock down that head and the neck area and put him on the board. We have seen his legs move and his arms move, which I think is a very positive sign.
Well, in recent years, they've really become more cognizant of not moving and making sure everything is stable. But he is moving his legs.
As a precaution, here comes the rescue team out onto the field. We saw the Auburn youngster. Same thing happened a week ago in the Mississippi State game. And they carried him off the field, went for x-rays as a precaution. Yeah. Had the sprained neck, and he will play tonight against LSU.
Well, some of the things they worry about, too, are some of the delayed effects of any kind of trauma. Looks like to his head, where the area where he got hit. So he's been moving, his legs are moving, but they just want to make sure everything is okay. Both coaches are out there, Mario Cristobal and Jim Leavitt.
Again, that's Brouce Mompremier, the senior from Miami. And they are taking every precaution when it involves the head or neck region. They will not take any chances whatsoever. And now is the time that you say a prayer and you hope everything is okay with this young man.
Senior out of Miami Edison High School.
And one of the young men who were so excited to come back here, and Wally Burnham, the longtime defensive mastermind of not only the South Florida defense, but those at Florida State when they won a national title back in 1993, absolutely loves this kid. And, you know, he's one of those kids that, as Wally said, just comes to work every day.
Yeah.
I mean, he's ready to go.
He said
and you don't have to worry about him.
He said his motor just never stops. And he's always asking questions of how to get better.
Well, again, as they put him into the full preparation in the hands of the medical team, they will take him immediately to the hospital where he will get x-rays. And the players, you look into his teammates' eyes and even those eyes of the FIU players, and you were obviously a great player in your own right, Charles. When this happens, I mean, you have to go back out. It's one of those things, you know, you hope the best for your teammate, but you have to go out and keep playing.
But the other thing is, you know, even though you're competing against another player, you still have concern for his family and everything else. So it concerns you from that, you know, from the football fraternity perspective.
All right, it's second down and 8, 6:43 to play in the third quarter. We'll be back to FIU Stadium in Miami in just a moment. Lowell, thank you very much. Back here at FIU Stadium in Miami, Florida. And just moments ago, Charles, I mean, this is really what it's all about. The two teams coming together to say a prayer for the fallen.
And this is what it should be about. We heard before we went to break a bunch of fans yelling some things that they shouldn't have been yelling, which was totally uncalled for. And if you hear this broadcast, you know who you are. It's totally insensitive. And I like what these folks are doing. All the players and all the coaches from both teams come together. This is what it's all about, folks.
Mm-hmm. Well, I agree. And that's terrific. I mean, that's sportsmanship. And even though you want to beat the other guy, I mean, you have respect for the man across the line of scrimmage. Brouce Mompremier now packed into that ambulance and will be taken immediately to the Miami-Dade County Hospital. And his family now is, his mom is walking onto the field right now. They're being escorted by South Florida officials. And she will crawl in the back of that ambulance as well and go with her son. And she's getting all the details. And there's the medical staff telling her what they know.
But, Doug, just once again, you know, both teams all coming together. And that...
That's his mom, Anna. In the play one more time. Mompremier is 53 and gets hit right at that awkward angle.
Carlton Williams also was shaken up. He has since walked off the field. So his family is concerned. They're there and they're letting them know what's going on.
Appears his mother has decided they have notified her they will give her a ride, obviously, to the hospital, or at least she can follow, and she's decided to do that. His sister, Jordan, is also with Mom Anna. And again, at this moment, the game is totally secondary to what we hope will be an excellent diagnosis. Jackson Memorial Hospital is just a few minutes away. And Brouce Mompremier will be taken there. And there's also a trauma center nearby here. And that is also at the hospital. So that is an excellent place for him to be going. As they strapped him down on that board with his helmet on. And we said it before, Buck, but I think it's appropriate to say a quick prayer and hope everything is okay with the young man. And he will be taken off, and we hope to have a report before we go off the air tonight. Certainly we will follow Brouce Mompremier to the hospital and keep our fingers crossed. As we resume action, it will be third down and 3 for FIU as they trail the 12th ranked team in the nation. There you see the South Florida family, the fans. So it's back to live action.
It'll be 3rd and 4 for the 42.
Let's see what FIU can do. Paul McCall is the quarterback, has gone the distance. 1 out of 7 third down conversions for the junior from Hollywood, Florida. Pump fake, nowhere to go. And he's in no man's land. He throws it up, and that was a bad pass that gets picked off. South Florida will take over at the 48. Jerome Murphy on the pick.
Great pressure by Jarriott Bowie. He just stayed after. You know, we talk about George Selvey so much, and Jerome Murphy has to just go shake Jarriott Bowie's hand. He almost has him there for the sack. He stays after it, keeps that pressure going. McCall, you can see him throwing off that back foot. He really can't settle even when he's in the pocket because he's been hurting since the first half. You see him throwing off of that back foot. Easy interception. You have five defenders in that area.
So the field position game has now changed in favor of South Florida. That was a bad mistake by McCall. Back to the ground it goes for the Bulls. Won't go down. Jamar Taylor finally just goes out of bounds. Gets a first down. Picks up 14 yards.
On the carry, number 33, Jamar Taylor.
Great play design also. Jonas Morrell was on the outside as the end. And when that fake came, he just went so far inside and missed the assignment totally.
Cristobal talking to his quarterback, telling him you got to throw that out of bounds. He needed to punt that ball away and back to Taylor. Looks like the same play. Breaks the tackle. First down the sidelines. Gets thrown out of bounds right around the 18 by Jeremiah Weatherspoon, who came close to grabbing that face mask. That was a 20-yard scamper.
Doug, so much time is prepared to stop Matt Grothy that you forget about the running back. See, everybody goes with Grothy, and you see it, that hesitation and good blocking right there, just enough. Cedric Hill over there. There could have been a hole right there on Carlton Mitchell, but everybody goes one way with Grothy, and that opens up holes and lanes for Jamar Taylor on the other side.
Back to Taylor. Looks like the same play three times in a row. And again, he burst forward for a nice gain. Dominguez on the tackle picks up six. That's 14, 20, yeah. Six.
And you know who also is there? Cedric Hill. Watch number nine. He's in your screen. He's going to be the lead guy right there. Right helmet to helmet. Right on the end. But he's committed and sprung the running back three separate plays.
Like the same play again, Buck. And once again, it's success. Hey, why not? Just keep going at it. And Jamar Taylor.
Until you stop it, we're going to run it. Greg Gregory, he's going back to his old Army days, his old wishbone days.
That was a 9-yard pickup. Greg Gregory spent 16 years the offensive coordinator of South Florida at Army. When the Cadets were running that bone and running over everybody, that was their most successful stint.
How excited did he get the other day when we talked about the wishbone of Jim Young?
Finally, they stop it. A little different formation, but the same play. And finally, they said, not that play again. No, Ryan Martinez comes up with a stop. Second down.
I like this drive because finally South Florida, after getting a turnover, decided, hey, we're going to run the football. They found a way to attack that defensive line, which has been so stout against Matt Grothy, and they're using him as a decoy in a sense every single time.
Second down and goal. There it is again. Jamar Taylor. The Bulls are really punching FIU in the mouth right now. Marshall McDuffie saves a touchdown. I mean, this is just down and dirty. Well, get in your face. Get out of my way. Football.
Let's give credit to Jacob Sims, Jake Griffin, Matt Huners, and Ryan Schmidt. The guys up front are really key in that play. Mark Dowell also, he's on the backside. But I tell you, they just come off the football and just pounded Florida International.
There's the wishbone look from Gregory. Mike Ford tried for a second touchdown. Haven't seen the signal. Lost the football. FIU says they have it. They certainly have the football right now. No signal.
Ryan Martinez came up with the football, but it looked like he was down.
It's FIU football. Mike Ford lost it. He's pleading his case that he was down on the turf.
The initial vantage point from here, Doug, looked like he was down.
And they will review this play. Let's watch it, Buck.
Watch right here. That angle doesn't show it. The ball, he's fighting for extra yards. And then when he reaches down, hits his elbow, he's down on the ground, and the ball then comes out. He has the ball even after he goes down.
Watch
him here.
Yeah, watch this replay. And it's blocked off, but watch the continuation. And the ball comes loose there after he's already laying on the ground.
Behind and his elbow were all down. This will give you a good definitive look, I think. He goes down there. He still has the ball. Then it comes out after the fact.
Yeah, that will be overturned. I think that's pretty definitive right there. He's laying on the ground, and now the ball squirts free.
But a case in point, you're always taught as a receiver or running back, try to hold on to the football for eternity. We had coaches that would come and try to strip it out even when you were on the ground, because back then there was no replay. Once they call something, it stuck. And I think the players now sometimes depend, hey, you know, I can show you the ball, but if a guy comes and knocks it out and they don't find a definitive answer and they call it a fumble on the field, it could still go against you. Right there in the 77, Jake Griffin's legs, you can see it. He has the ball. Then the ball comes out like he was just fighting the stretch a little bit more. Really not a lot of push. Great effort by Florida International again of forcing him back inside, but there's no one there. Some of that, too, Doug, is not playing for the last 2 weeks. Speed of the game.
And it was a few minutes ago when Brouce Mompremier, the linebacker for South Florida, was taken off the field. We saw him taken off by ambulance, but they did bring in an emergency helicopter outside FIU Stadium. There it is. And they loaded Mompremier onto the helicopter to take him immediately to the trauma center, which is nearby. So the medical staff and the local hospitals were right on top of it. That's great news. The sooner you can get him there, get the x-rays, and find out what exactly is going on, the better, especially when you're dealing with that spinal column injury.
Well, you think
perhaps
about Kevin
Hopefully
Everett,
not that.
You know, in his situation, and anything with head or neck trauma, they have now been taught to really take care of it as quickly as you can. Because like I said before, some of the after effects and the long-term effects are predicated on what you do initially.
Mm-hmm.
Coach's challenge is taking a while. They're still having those issues.
They're having an issue where they have to actually go to the sidelines again on a telephone because the headset is not working upstairs with the replay official. First game at the stadium. There's also obviously some bugs in the system.
Don't you think if they don't get it right, Jim Leavitt's going to run over there like his pregame sprints?
Well, I'm not sure how they can.
I wouldn't want to be the one to tell him.
Sure how they can not get it right, because it was pretty obvious that he was down on the ground when the ball came loose. And our officiating crew is a Big East crew. That's Dennis Hennigan. And if you watch a lot of Big East games, and we call Big East games, he is one of the top officials in the league.
Looks like he was clearly down.
See, the ball right there isn't even out yet. And there finally comes free, and he has been sprawled on the ground for at least a full second.
Doug, let's say this also. Ed Hockley had a call last week, and he got lambasted by San Diego fans. They should, at least he came out and apologized for it. And I give the guy a lot of credit for that. It's not easy doing this job. These guys, you know, they get it right, but when they don't, people let them know. But clearly here, you have the challenge of, in effect, where the ball comes out way after he's already down.
I think it's going to be reversed, and it'll be fourth and goal for South Florida. And Jim Leavitt,
he's waiting to run. I'm telling you, as soon as they make the call, if it doesn't go his way, he's running over here.
That last replay we showed, and our guys are putting together a nice group of replays for the replay officials. And again, the ball came free after he had been laying on the ground. You see Griffin, he was already motioning, hey, he was down. That's Jake Griffin, the senior center. He's been around the block a few times. And they're just making sure Dennis Hennigan.
See, Leavitt, he's at the hash mark now. He's going to get closer and closer. But it clearly shows that he had possession of the ball. It comes out after he's on the ground.
And I think you're right, Buck. Mike Ford injured on the last carry of the very first game.
That's right, FIU fans. DJ
South Florida took on Tennessee Martin. His first action since, and I think there's a little ring rust.
Yeah, I agree.
He's talking to Carl Franks, who was the head coach at Duke and North Carolina. and now has settled in as the running backs coach at South Florida. I mean, Jim Leavitt has a heck of a staff.
He really does. He's put some people together to really help him. And they also help in recruiting. These guys have experience in other places, and they've done a very good job of getting talent. They've been working Florida very hard, but he even said, we're going to start expanding. We're going up into Georgia now. We're going to some other places.
Jim Leavitt, the only head coach in South Florida football history. Leavitt pacing. And once again, if you're watching this game on ESPN HD, which they have here in these premier suites, and it is an incredible way to watch a sporting event.
It gives you more of the camera angle. You can see more.
And those folks with HD can see that replay. Yeah.
And it's in its full.
As clear as a bell. And again, Buck, I'm not sure why this is taking so long. I mean, I know they were having problems communicating upstairs, but it's pretty obvious in our replays that he was down.
Yeah, I mean, I keep looking at it. I can't see why it wouldn't be that way. And finally, we're going to get a call here.
After review, the runner was down before the ball came loose. There is no fumble on the play. It will be South Florida's ball, fourth down at the one-yard line.
Well, Cristobal didn't like it, but when he sees the replays.
The call on the field has been overturned.
Well, it also, what it doesn't do justice for the Florida International folks, it took so long. If they had made a decision sooner, that would have helped.
All right, Greg Gregory, the old Army coach, has to have that wishbone look. Look how tight they are in the offensive line. Grothy keeps it himself. That was fourth down. FIU says they stopped him.
Oh, wow.
They kept him out of the end zone. Cristobal is fired up.
Oh, man.
He's back to his playing days. Yeah. Wearing the shoulder pads and helmet, the coach wants to play.
Hey, I'm surprised he hadn't done any chest bumps and head bumps. Wow. But that's the intensity. Oh, there it is. I told you. Where the chest bump comes from, Coach Cristobal. I like it.
That was Jonas Morell, who's only 350 pounds. They put him in to clock things up, and he did.
He did. Really got underneath in submarine, and you can see all those big guys. Finally, the defensive tackles did a very good job of getting pressure. Matt Grothy, a strong guy. Maybe that 20-pound weight loss hurt him instead of helped him on that play.
So from the half-yard line, FIU throwing out of their own end zone, and they completed a rare completion. Paul McCall to Greg Ellingson, five-yard pickup.
That's a huge play when you're backed up like that.
Hey, let's go down to the sidelines. Melissa Knowles. Melissa.
Doug, I talked to Coach Cristobal at halftime, and he told me he was extremely pleased with the way his entire team played during that first half, but particularly the defense. Now he wants them to take advantage of these kind of opportunities and learn to control the ball.
Let's see if what they've learned, Melissa, on second down. This one, almost a bad snap. And then McCall thought better than to hand it off, and he keeps it himself. That could have been ugly.
Doug, and I just don't quite understand either when we thought we'd see Wayne Younger. Nothing against Paul McCall, but he's not able to run the football. You saw it there. He made a great stop. Good one-hand catch. But he really cannot run if he has to. And in this area, where that defense is coming after you with Jarriott Bowie and George Selby, this is the danger area for this Florida International offense.
You saw Bill Legg on the sidelines. He's the guy that looked like the old offensive lineman, the big guy there. Calling in the play on third down now, FIU. McCall has plenty of time. Keeps it himself, and it'll be fourth down. Picks up five, about 6 inches short. Keon Wilson on the stop for the Bulls.
George Selby goes down, and he's limping off. See, the problem on that play, the reason why guys got hurt, Terrell McClain got hurt also, they were hitting each other. It was so many white jerseys around that's how you usually get hurt. We call it friendly fire in football. Guys on your own team, when they come in and they come to hit you, they may sometimes close their eyes and pound you instead of the ball carrier.
They bring out the chains and they will measure. And just inches away, I think you got to kick this football away.
Yeah,
I mean, you can't take a chance.
And your quarterback doesn't have any legs. He can't run. Now, you're going to see at the very tail end, George Selvey, what I say about friendly fire. Look at all these white jerseys around us. A lot of times, these guys that are flying to the football close their eyes, and they don't see, and they just hit you. You get bent up in that pile.
Selvey, you see him on the sidelines checking that ankle out. Bonera, his seventh punt of the day, a 35.3 average so far in the first six. Not a bad kick out to the 50. Theo Wilson looking for some room. And he loses yardage on that return. That was a 35-yard kick, a 4-yard on the negative side return. All season long, ESPNU, your source for college football information. Monday, 7 Eastern, it's Lowell Galindo, Coach Godfrey, Tom Luganville, the best in recruiting. It's called Inside the Polls, presented by 76. And then Lowell and my partner, Charles Arbuckle, Coach's Spotlight, presented by Liberty Mutual, Tuesday at 1 Eastern. Remember, your place for everything in college sports is ESPNU.com. Video, audio highlights, podcasts, live streaming games, and a whole lot more, ESPNU.com. Matt Grothy and the Bulls on the reverse. Dontavia Bogan looking for blockers, gets a great block, and then gets tied up at the 34-yard line by who else but Robert Mitchell. 19-yard pickup, but he's had a heck of a game.
Well, Dontavia Bogan is supposed to have the best hand, but he showed some speed right there, Doug, getting around the outside. And you know what I like about the last drive and so far now? They're not allowing Matt Grothy to take those extra hits. We talked about it earlier with Tim Tebow. You expose your quarterback to too many shots if you run them too much and too early in the season.
Here comes the blitz on the outside. Coming in to make that tackle is Jeremiah Witherspoon. And down on the ground is Ryan Schmidt. Big left tackle. And he comes up hobbling, actually hopping on one leg.
It looks like he got his ankle rolled.
Ooh. Boy, the Bulls are really going down here in this third quarter. And he'll try to just shake it off and stay in the game.
Yeah, he's trying to shake it off. But if you're the defensive lineman and they actually are throwing the football in this instance, Jonathan Jackson, the freshman, ought to be thinking, I got a guy that can't protect against me if I'm coming off the edge.
Grothy setting up the screen. There's a first down and a whole lot more. Getting down to the 15-yard line was Benjamin Williams. 20 yards on the screen pass. Desiriah Johnson on the stop for FIU, but now before a big game.
Well, good job by Grothy of just waiting for Benjamin Williams because everybody's coming after him. They really didn't set up a true screen. He checked it down, got it over the top, and allowed him to get down the field.
And that's the end of the third quarter. It has been an emotional third quarter with Brouce Mompremier of South Florida going down and going to the hospital. And then the big goal line stand, the fumble recovery, getting Cristobal all revved up with one quarter to play. It's the start of the fourth quarter, FIU Stadium in Miami. Grothy to the outside. And Torres Johnson evaded the first tackle, and then Anthony Gator gobbled him up, picks up one.
Well, Torres Johnson is a guy that's a big play player for him. And I was expecting to see him play a little bit earlier and really get a chance to watch him. But if he doesn't get the ball early, Doug, he tends to kind of coast and get upset. That was a nice catch for him. But, man, he can make a big play for you if you need it.
Number 7, Anthony Gator, and number 53, Michael Dominguez.
Grothy, see those eyes through the shield. Looking to throw it back, wide open, and bounces it to Cedric Hill.
The reason he couldn't get it there, Quentin Newman was coming off and really stopped him from throwing that ball to Cedric Hill.
Let's find out the condition of the All-American George Selvey. Melissa.
Guys, you saw him go off the field limping towards the end of the third quarter. When he came over to the sideline, they examined his right ankle. They loosened his shoelaces. Then they had him stand up to try to put some weight on it. He limped around on a little bit, and then he sat back down. Now they've iced it and taped it up. So I'm not sure if we're going to see him come back in during this fourth quarter.
Yeah, that does not look good. And that's usually what you do when you get one of those high ankle sprains. You keep the shoe on to keep it from swelling up, and you throw that ice on the high part of the ankle. Now third down. Here comes the blitz. Everybody in the kitchen sink. Grothy squirts out of there and stretches down to the 3-yard line. Late flag, late hit as they pounced on the quarterback, Anthony Gator, on the stop.
Carry, number 8, Mac Grothy, brought down by
now, this is what he brings to the table for you. Last week he did it with his arm, and now this week he's doing it with his legs on the ground. He has that uncanny knack just to make people miss and get through those tackles.
Jonathan,
late hit right there.
Jonathan Betancourt, that was
really late.
Yeah, that was uncalled for. It. That was helmet to helmet, late.
And Grothy is hot. But he's a fiery competitor. Yes, you see the penalty difference there. Not a whole lot. Florida International with more than South Florida.
And a timeout, FIU. FIU, they want to make sure they have the right guys in. Jonas Morrell, big 350-pound defensive tackle. They need to get in there. He's the run stopper. Remember, coming up after our game, it's Fresno State, 25th-ranked Bulldogs, taking on Toledo at 8:15, and then Tuskegee and Stillman. I've done games at Tuskegee and Stillman, Buck, and they love their football. They're passionate. That's a big rivalry, by the way. That's 11:30 tonight on the U. College football primetime presented by Citi. Boy, a lot of good football on today and tonight. You see Carl Franks talking to Matt Grothy. Franks coached with Steve Spurrier for many years and then was inherited the job at Duke. And I think I mentioned he was at North Carolina, but that meant just Duke. One of the very experienced and talented coaches on this South Florida staff. I love talking to Carl Franks. I mean, he's just a good old-fashioned football coach. Man, he burns the midnight oil, watches tons of tape, loves it. Back to the ground, boy. Wow. Putting the head down and getting a shot. Is that
Ben
just
Williams.
Short of the goal line, Ben Williams.
That's called running behind your pads. I mean, he just laid the boom. And when you run behind your pass, Ben Williams has been hurt. Watch this. Look at the legs and look at the leg drive here. Boom! It took Scott Bryant by surprise. He couldn't even get his pads underneath him to stop. Benjamin Williams, with that low center of gravity at 5'7", 200 pounds, delivered the blow. He's upset he didn't score.
Mike Ford now in for Ben Williams. There was movement first from the FIU defensive front. And then Papello was drawn off by South Florida. I think this will go against FIU.
Neutral zone infraction. Number 93 on the defense. Penalty is half the distance to the goal. Second down.
Ricky Booker is trying to make it go the other way.
Can't do that in college.
No.
Maybe you could have gotten away with that in the NFL, but not in college when you jump in that zone. Again, Ford, the double tight. Ford, his second touchdown of the game.
The carry by number 26, Mike Ford.
Bulls on top, 16-0. Got to toss it right to the official.
Well, Paul Galliano was saying that these were the two guys he was worried about, seeing Mike Ford and Ben Williams. He thought they would be back. And this is good old-fashioned power football here. The white jerseys push the blue jerseys into the end zone. You're going to get 6 points every time on that.
Mike Ford, the young man from Sarasota. When he came out, one of the top running backs from this state, originally signed with Alabama, and the extra point is good. Mike Shula, he really liked Mike Shula and went to prep school, wanted to come back home to Florida, and now he is a bona fide star for the South Florida Bulls.
one just a stone's throw from South Beach. Today's game brought to you by ESPN High Definition. And I tell you what, there's nothing quite like South Beach, bud. The crew is down there.
Oh, man.
Cutting some rug. I think they still call it cutting rug, don't they? No, Rick Baker, our stats guy, was up on stage last night.
They stopped doing that. They stopped calling it that. You got to ask these guys now. I don't know what they call
it. What do you call that, what Rick was doing last night? There was dancing, wasn't it?
No. He was attempting to dance.
It's fun being in South Florida. And the South Florida Bulls now lead 17-0. Tichy's shortest kick yet. And there he is. That's the young man who's got everyone so excited, T.Y. Hilton.
On the return.
Just when he touches it, everybody gets, he has the ball.
And he gets a friendly bump at the end from Louis Gachette. But right here, this is the excitement that everybody here at FIU has for this young man. Great speed. Got a late hit there. Watch the little bump by Louis Gachette. One thing about him is that they need to get him the ball in space. And I want to see them use him like they do Burt Reed at Florida State or Preston Parker. You got to get him incorporated.
New quarterback Wayne Younger now checks in. 13:02 to play in the football game. First time we've seen this young man from Cocoa Beach. Julian Reams to the outside flag down. They'll bring that back. That was a hold. Ulo Matavayo
on the carry, number 32, Julian Reams.
Had a whole bunch of jersey on this one.
Yeah, watch 51. But Julian Reams finally with some running, just a real good burst. Got away from Jarrett Bowie. You're not going to see there's a takedown right there at the top of your screen. But Reams finally decided to run the football effectively, and when he got that opportunity, there was a takedown by Matavayo that they didn't really even need.
So that nullifies a very positive run. And one more look. There's 51.
Right there on Carlton Williams. I mean, he has him grabbing him, and then he's going to the WWF him. Woo!
That was a textbook hole. That's the kind they show in our preseason meetings at ESPN. That's a hole. And back to the ground. It goes to Julian Reams, who goes nowhere. Selvey is not back in the game. Looks like he's through for the evening. The All-American who rolled his ankle. Marshall in there getting some time now.
They could have called Matavale again for a hold. He had Jared Bowie on him, and Bowie just got around. He reached back and almost forced collared him.
Bring up second and 15 for FIU.
Second and 15 now, Wayne Younger. Got a lot of playing time a year ago. They broke their long losing streak with a win against North Texas in the season finale. Younger with a nice gain, and that's what he brings to the table.
Exactly.
He has wheels.
They want him to be more efficient in the passing area, but this is what he can do for you. And for a South Florida team that likes to run and overcommit sometimes, he makes the difference. Now, what did we talk to with Bill Legg? He said stay in choice downs, third and mid and second and short. They haven't been that way most of the day, and that's why they struggled to gain yards. With Wayne Younger on that play, Doug, he gets you in third and six, which is more manageable than third and 15.
Gets the play from the sidelines. Only four first downs on the night. Had a tough time with the snap. Gets close to the first down. Joseph Sabbath. Joseph with a stop. 5-yard pickup. Talking to Bill Legg, the new offensive coordinator, talking about both quarterbacks. They both have strengths, and I'm trying to get one of them to be a complete guy. I'd like to just melt the two of them into one body. But you can't do that.
No. And that's always the difficulty when you get to a new situation. You don't have a quarterback that you need for the offense that you're trying to run. Looks like they're going to go for it, which I think is wise.
At this stage of the game, it's a must. And it appears that he got the first down. It will be very close, but I do think he surged past the mark because we are right on the mark here in the Premier Suite, ESPNU Premier Suite.
And that's what he brings, Wayne Younger. He waited, he was able to get around, and he was able to show how he can move over to the side and get that first down. There's another player down.
And once again, there is no press box here at FIU Stadium. They'll build that at a different time. And so we're in a premier suite right at the 50-yard line, and I guess it's, for now, the ESPNU premier suite.
They were going to bring us some popcorn. We were going to be like the fans. We've actually been high-fiving the guys. There's a USF person here, FIU, so we've been into the game, trying to call our game, flat things flying around us, but we're okay.
And there is no cover.
No.
We weren't sure because there was rain in the forecast, but thank goodness it did not rain because we would have got a little wet.
Yeah,
there's no cover. It would have been hard to go in and call it inside, but we'll be back. Another injured player. This one not serious. Back in a moment. ESPNU College Football presented by Citi. Whatever your story is, your Citi card can help write it because Citi never sleeps. This city stays up pretty late at night. I'll tell you what, especially at South Beach. Back to the ground game. After the first down from Younger, they go to Julian Reams. And let's look at stat track. South Florida has dominated from the get-go. And that's what we expected, especially in the rushing department. And we expected those kind of numbers. Overall, FIU just struggles mightily on offense.
Yeah, and I just thought on that play, Doug, they would have let Wayne Younger make the play fake to Reams and pull it out. There was no one on that backside. He would have been still running had he pulled that ball out.
In the blitz. For the moment, Younger evades the blitz. He's got to get rid of it. And wow, that is caught. That was Junior Mertil, his first catch. True freshman from Miami.
That was nice. What Wayne Younger can do for you. Move around. And while we were in the break, you're going to see George Selby taking off.
Younger keeps it himself and gets another first down. That's two in a row. First time tonight they've had two in a row, and the All-American leaving on the cart. Next week, NC State.
It's not a good thing. They've lost quite a few players. A lot of guys have been shaken up throughout the whole day.
Well, he gave the student section the signal that he was okay. We shall see. Those ankle injuries, there's not a lot you can do for it. Six first downs in the night. And
it's a free play right there.
Jared Bowie just jumped too early. And then a late flag came in. So you had Bowie offsides. And you had the holding penalty, too. So these should offset.
Holding, number 78 on the offense. Offsides, number 90 on the defense. The penalty's offset. First down.
Those are the kind of penalties that kill you if you're FIU. You get them offsides, you get a free play. Jared Bowie comes off. He's ready to go. And then you hold him on the other end of it. Just does not help you. Dustin Gibson, left guard.
So first down all over again. Wayne Younger overshoots his man, and a late flag comes in. That'll be pass interference, at least holding by Jerome Murphy, looking for Greg Ellingson.
Yeah, that was pretty obvious, too, Doug. It's holding here, but then you also have it down the field. That push. And you can see Jerome Murphy. He got beat. And when he did, he tried to stay, and all he could do was push his receiver down. And this makes you think, like I said, I thought we would see Wayne Younger sooner, and he's brought a spark to this offense. They have struggled to score, so I can't. They need to come away with at least three, but for sure if they can get it, seven.
FIU has not experienced an offensive touchdown so far this season. And a flag down. I think Bowie jumped the gun a little quickly.
On the carry, number 32, Julian Reams, tackled by number 90.
Well, that's exactly what the call is. Could be a costly night for the 12th-ranked Bulls.
Well, that's what we talked about. A lot of guys have gone out. Brouce, Mompremier, we don't know what the significance of his injury is, but George Selby, ankle, Terrell McLean looked like he was limping with the lower leg, ankle, or shin.
And another flag, this time the right tackle for FIU moves, so that'll be motion against.
Number 50 on the offense.
That's Alajagian, Joe Alajagian. He moved too quickly, and he's flinching, he's a little gun-shy because Bowie's been jumping him.
Well, the other thing is you can almost say, well, it's a new quarterback, but he's been in for a while, so it's not the quarterback. You've got to hold your water, and you got a positive thing going here now. Stay. Wayne Younger can make that first guy miss. He's been doing well at that, so stay and hold your water.
Coming up a little bit later on, we'll join the game in progress. Fresno State against Toledo on ESPNU, our primetime Saturday night contest presented by Citi. And that game will be kicking off momentarily. Injuries are part of it. A year ago when they reached number two in the country, injuries really played a huge part of that three-game losing streak for South Florida. Younger shows the ability to get out of trouble.
On the carry, number 14, Wayne Younger.
And we are told some good news. The Associated Press, they're here tonight covering this first game ever in the FIU Stadium. They reported that before Mompremier was put into the evacuation helicopter, that his hands were moving. The reporter reported that, so that is very encouraging news.
We saw some movement here, so that's good to hear that happened also. But getting back to that last play, Wayne Younger, that's the one thing they want him to do. Bill Legg said, get rid of the football a little bit quicker.
Amon Ned hasn't carried it since early in the game. Sprawls forward for a gain of two. As you look at the sidelines of South Florida, you not only see Jim Leavitt, but Wally Burnham, the defensive coordinator. And he's been in this business only for 42 years.
He's old school, man.
There he is.
He's always coach. He coaches every play. What did Bobby Bowden say about Mickey Andrews? They act alike. You can't talk to them before the game either. They have their game face on. During the week, they joke and laugh with you. On game day, you better leave those guys alone.
Wally is revved up. Imagine him and Mickey Andrews on the same staff, which they were for 9 years. Younger had his man and just missed it. Speaking of Burnham, he told us, he said, hey, I told our grad assistant to shut those darn things off. He didn't say darn, by the way. It's time to go to work. I don't even know how to turn on a computer. I still use the grease board.
Hey, what did I say, Doug, a few years ago? He can write the book on how to stop the spread. Who came to visit him? Ohio State, Colorado, Minnesota, with a whole bunch of other schools. They want to know how to do it. He said the main key, stop the quarterback. You stop him on those trap ISO read drive plays or dive plays, that's the key. He's going to write a book one day, I'm telling you.
Dustin Rivas, 40-yard field goal to try to get FIU on the board. He gets plenty of leg into it, and it's no good. Wide right. The shutout continues for Wally Burnham and the 12th-ranked Bulls in Miami. They lead it 17-0. Jim Leavitt's Bulls, 12th in the country, have dominated this affair tonight. And Leavitt now talking to Wally Burnham. Some costly injuries for the Bulls. We don't know how serious, but they lose their All-American, who leaves with an ankle sprain. George Selvey and their senior linebacker, Brouce Mompremier, has been taken to the hospital. We've heard reports from the AP that things are okay. That's all we've heard, so we don't want to say any more as they go back to the ground game. Jamar Taylor. 5-yard pickup. I guess we should say encouraging news with the movement of the hands reported by the Associated Press.
You know, Doug, and you talk about East Carolina losing earlier today. You have to look at what they lost Quentin Cotton, the linebacker. That makes a big difference. So if Selvey misses any significant time, that could really hurt the South Florida Bulls. I don't think people realize how important a player can be. And then Brouce Mompremier, we don't know what the extent of his injuries are. So they've lost some big-time players on their defense.
Second and long now. Grothy will keep it himself. And South Florida will continue to run this clock, picking up three. Remember, coming up immediately after our game, we will check in with Fresno State and Toledo. All presented by City. And I can't wait to see that one. Fresno State. Very good. Five out of 12 now on third downs. The South Florida Bulls. Good news to have Mike Ford back in the lineup tonight. He was out with an ankle sprain the last two games. Didn't even play against Kansas. Good look at Grothy. Keeps it himself. Flag down. Usually in the area of a hold, and I think that'll be called on Jesse Hester.
I think also Ryan Smith. He was out there holding Quentin Newman. And he goes right over to the official to try to plead his case.
Look at Grothy there. He's lost 18 pounds since the spring. Wanted to get in better shape. Upcoming NC State knocks off East Carolina today. That's on the U next week. That's at NC State. Without Selvey and others, who knows if they're going to be back. That's a trap.
It's a dangerous game for South Florida. And kind of what I said before, how they finish the season is really important to me. They start off strong the last 2 years, but haven't been able to put things away late in the season. If they're going to win the Big East title, they've got to be prepared to really get going in their schedule.
Hilton kicked by Alvarado. T.Y. Hilton gets his hands on another ball. Flag down on the play, gets to the outside, turns on the Jets. Knocked out of bounds at the 31. A flag down back at the 38-yard line. This young man.
Man, I tell you what, though. Even if this comes back, he is exciting to watch.
The legend of T.Y. Hilton. He was All-State football, All-State in basketball when he was 12 years old. Jose Canseco, the Jose Canseco here at a softball game, charity softball game.
It was the first time he picked up a bat.
Picked up a bat, hit a home run, and Canseco said, whoever is listening needs to sign this kid and be his agent.
Well, he said, I want to be his agent when he becomes famous. I mean, and he came to FIU because he wanted to help build a program. Now, the one thing he does well is catch and go. And look, the block in the back, you saw it in your screen. But he has the ability to get outside and really make some exciting things happen. He ran from the other side of the field, and had he been able to get by one player, he would have scored had that block in the back not happened. The thing that I want to see with him is the ball in his hands in open field.
Haven't seen it.
No, we haven't seen it.
Two punt returns, and that's it.
I mean, it's a short throw, but let him run. He's got some Eric Metcalf in him. Eric Metcalf was just like that. You give him a little crease and he's gone.
Back to the ground, Amon Ned. 8-yard pickup. One more non-conference game for the Golden Panthers at Toledo. And then they get ready for the Sun Belt. North Texas licking their chops. They lost to FIU a year ago. They'd lost 23 in a row, the Golden Panthers, and knocked off North Texas in the season finale. So they're anxious for FIU to return that game. That ball batted in the air.
Ben Younger has a strong arm, too, Doug. Sometimes too strong. A couple of throws that were hot. That's the one thing they want to work with him on, his ability to get some of that touch on the football.
Coming up next, Fresno State Toledo, and they will delay the start of that game to 8:21 Eastern time, and we'll get you there as soon as we can. 2 out of 12 now on third downs. FIU going with Wayne Younger, came in at the 13 minute mark of this fourth quarter and just rifled it to the outside, and that will be short of the first down.
That's a prime example of what I just talked about, the play where you give the guy something where he can easily catch the ball and turn up the field. You throw it too hard, he can't do anything with it. That was Jason Frierson. He catches the pass, but he has no chance to turn. It was such a hot pass to him.
Younger keeps it himself and gets the first down. Picks up three.
You know, we don't see it at this time, T.Y. Hilton in the game either. I know he's been injured and coming back slowly, Bill Legg said, but I would think with his explosiveness, you'd have him in the ball game right now.
These FIU kids 83 from the state of Florida, almost all of them from South Florida. You know, there's a pride thing going. They do not want to be shut out. That ball gets batted down. That's big Chris Robinson, one of those high motor guys, always in motion.
Had a big play earlier in special teams. Real nice tackle.
Wally Burnham is really coaching him up on the sidelines.
Well, and he's getting an opportunity to play the rush in with George Selvey out. So he's getting a chance to come off that edge. And he's showing you, hey, George is good, but I'm going to play my game as well.
Younger. Rifling it to your guy, T.Y. Hilton, who had about two steps on the defender.
That's one of those passes where if you play it and you've done it enough in the game, you put air on it. He tried to rifle it in as opposed to letting T.Y. run underneath it. He had two steps. And all you need is that. If he puts a little air on it, that's 6 points.
Younger looking at that wristband. Looks at the sidelines, then gets his guys in the right formation, trying to get FIU on the board. Their first offensive touchdown of the year. Can it come in the final minutes as he overshoots Greg Ellingson on the outside?
The other thing, Wayne Younger has had some shoulder problems, and he's really just, it's either going to be really, really hard, or it might be high. He still doesn't have his act.
Pretty from an offensive standpoint for FIU. What a struggle this season. You see a glimmer of hope. Wayne Younger is coming and giving a little bit of a spark. And let's see that. They're going to give him credit for saving that at the 2 yard line. 60 yard punt.
Wow.
Best one of the night. And hustling down there to save that ball was Alonzo Phillips. Boy, he walked the tight wire in this and saved that football from going in the end zone.
Great hustle play. Oh, nice.
Ooh, I'm not sure their right foot didn't touch the end zone.
He got away with one there. Well, he had it first, and then he tried to be dramatic and kind of show a little flair. And fall over. You should have downed it right there. Almost hit a line from Dancing with the Stars.
Back to the ground game, and Mike Ford trying to knock off that rust as South Florida gets ready for a road trip to NC State. Tom O'Brien and his staff. They improve as they go along.
Yeah, they were left for dead after the first week of the season. You know, after South Carolina just plastered them. You didn't think North Carolina State would come back and beat ECU, but that's usually a rivalry game between those two.
George Selvey is back now on the bench, which is a great sign. Went in to get that tape, a retape job on the ankle.
Yeah, they probably also went to x-ray if they have that capability here just to make sure there was no structural damage.
Thank you.
Got the shoe off.
All smiles, so perhaps that's a good sign for South Florida. I was just looking at the mohawk of Aaron Harris. That is a freshly cut mohawk. Remember Matt Grothy last year?
Yeah.
Had the mohawk look going.
I wonder how much you pay the barber to do that. Or you just get one of your boys and just,
I hope you don't pay much. That doesn't take a lot of talent.
His mom's at home like, baby, why did you do that? Why did you do that to your hair? You got good hair. It's good.
South Florida with the movement.
44 in the offense.
So South Florida will go to 3-0.
Second down.
And I know Jim Leavitt, and he will not be pleased with this performance. Very sloppy.
Yeah.
At times dominating. And you go back to that Kansas game in the third quarter against Kansas. They were unbelievable, hitting on all cylinders. That's what they're capable of.
Yeah.
But clearly not close to that tonight.
The focus tonight clearly wasn't as strong. And I think Florida International had something to do with it also, Doug, with how they played defense tonight.
Mike Ford, another flag is down. The end of this game has become very sloppy. Robert Mitchell, another stop.
On the carry, number 26,
we were talking about that Grothy mohawk.
17, Robert Mitchell.
And he left a little tough on the top.
Yeah, he's got a little curl going there at the top.
And he's trying to match the ball.
And then there's the...
That's the fro-mo.
The new the look from Aaron Harris.
That ain't a mohawk, that's the fro-hawk.
I mean, that is freshly cut, huh?
Yes.
Talking to George Selvey. Selvey all smiles. Selvey, a guy who reminds me a lot of Jason Taylor, now with the Washington Redskins. Not sure he can dance like Jason Taylor, but... You know, an undersized defensive end that gets by in that quickness.
But most people want those guys now that can really come off the corner, off the edge.
And it's going to be a safety. FIU does not get shut out. They're on the board with a safety, 17-2. Ryan Martinez wraps up Mike Ford.
They'll take it any way they can get it. They've been wanting some points. And you can see Mario Cristobal has to be happy with his defensive effort tonight. These guys have really stepped up. Paul Galliano said, our guys are going to fight hard, and this is how you do it. Good pressure. Now, that looked like the offense was the defense. And they just came off the ball and just really got into the end zone, did not give Mike Ford any running lanes on that play.
Remember, coming up, it's Fresno State and Toledo. And as soon as our game is over, we will toss it out to that one. Jim Leavitt and Mario Cristobal. Boy, they are still coaching. And when you sit down and talk to these guys, I mean, you feel like you can go out and play.
Yeah, they'll make you suit up.
They are emotional. Guys, we talked to Leavitt on Wednesday, and we talked to Cristobal yesterday in his office, and these guys, man, they are passionate. They love the game so much. And I think they are the perfect coaches for their respective schools.
Well, it doesn't hurt if you think of Mario Cristobal and some of his influences. Butch Davis was at Miami, now at North Carolina. Greg Schiano, who's built the program from scratch at Rutgers. He played and has been around Larry Coker as well.
So South Florida chooses. You could punt or kick off. They choose to kick off. Why not Justin Tichy really boots it in T.Y. Hilton? Another return. Loses the football.
The return by number four.
He got it back.
He got it back.
He's a tough guy. I like him.
Let's join Lowell Galindo in the studio for a SportsCenter U in-game update.
Cardinal Center football.
Ooh, you can't give up.
Yeah. You got to stay with the play. Finish the play. We'd be doing up-downs back in the day, Doug. Cut away.
Younger. There's T.Y. Hilton. Gets a great block. T.Y. Hilton gets down inside the two-yard line. There's still an opportunity for FIU to get their first offensive touchdown.
Doug.
60 yards on the play.
Watching this kid on film, he leaps out at him. Every time he touches the ball, he seems to just make something happen. And right here in the middle of the field, in man coverage, he catches the ball and just goes with a great block right there. But he's just an outstanding player to watch. And if they can ever get him the ball in space, he is going to be a tough guy to bring down.
The play is good for 62 yards.
So Wayne Younger, FIU. Looking to get in the end zone, and South Florida calls timeout. Wally Burnham tells everybody, all 11, to get over here.
I catch him in man coverage, and he almost gets sacked, but gets it over the top, and then the block here. Great by Ellingson. Good job of the cut block on Nate Allen.
Verpel saved the touchdown.
Yes, he did. He didn't give up on the play.
Mario Cristobal wants a touchdown in the worst sort of way, and Wally Burnham wants to keep him out of that end zone in the worst sort of way.
Well, this is what we talked about at halftime, Doug. Why not go with Wayne Younger, especially when Paul McCall just did not, you know, nothing against him. He just couldn't play. He couldn't run. And you can see how well this team has responded with Wayne Younger. Even when he's missed on some passes, he was only 2 of 7 before this drive started, now 3 of 8. But that was a huge play to T.Y. Ellington. Excuse me.
T.Y. Hilton.
We got that power eye set. Got the H-back set up. Boy, going nowhere is Amon Ned.
On the carry, number three, Amon Ned.
Rappel and company shut him down again.
Well, I tell you who really made the play, Keon Wilson. He stopped the hole. He comes in and just roots the fullback out and doesn't allow Amon Ned to even get anywhere. And if he, once he leaves his feet, the defenders just converge on him.
Second down from the 1.5. Closing in on a minute to play. Ned goes right in the middle in the teeth of that South Florida defense.
Doug, again, I'm going to tell you. Keon Wilson. Watch Keon Wilson here in the ISO block. He takes it on and just destroys it. And that allows his secondary mates to come and help him. That's a good ISO play by a linebacker just going in. And that's the same play they called before. It's man-on-man ISO block between the fullback and the linebacker. Chalk it up 2 times in a row. Keon Wilson won that battle.
Wally Burnham coached at Florida State for 9 years. In 1993, they won the national championship. Brad Scott took the South Carolina job, left the FSU staff, took Wally Burnham with him. Spent 5 years in South Carolina, and when Scott was fired, Burnham found a home at South Florida. And this man is one of the outstanding defensive minds in the nation. And you mentioned it, Buck. Already Ohio State, Colorado, Minnesota came this summer to view tape with Wally Burnham, and we saw what Colorado did against West Virginia.
Yeah.
They wouldn't know how to stop the spread.
The spread is one of the things, and that's perfect for Colorado knowing they're playing West Virginia. People are catching up now to Pat White, forcing him to throw the ball and not letting him get out in space. And Wally Burnham has written a book on it. Let's watch 35 Trenet Turner go against, again, if they go that same play, Keon Wilson, 42.
Same formation, this time going wide. Reams into the end zone, and FIU has their first touchdown of the 2008 season.
That time, instead of going ISO lead block, they get outside, and they use their speed on the outside, which is a smart play, Doug, because that inside was just not going to happen. Trenard Turner gets the lead block, and Reams scores 6.
All right, Buck, they need to get the extra point and then kick the onside kick. They got an opportunity tie this thing if the stars are aligned. Rivas on for the extra point. Moves it through, so that pulls them within 8. And now you gotta do the onside kick.
Onside kick. If you're able to get a score, 2-point conversion. Look, the last few plays, they tried to go inside. Look at the good blocking outside. Mertil and Turner with a good block on the outside, and the hole opens up because they were so focused from the last two plays on the ISO lead block. Reams gets it in for 6.
So the good hands people will come onto the field for South Florida, and we'll see how much FIU's practice the onside kick.
Well, we talked about it in the first half. If the game stayed close, sooner or later, you get the ball in the hands of T.Y. Hilton, big things usually happen. It finally did. He scores or gets close to scoring and puts them in scoring position. And now, onside kick. Anything can happen.
Set to kick off for FIU number 40, Dustin
Rivas. Dustin Rivas will try to put the mojo on this football. He's aiming for the left side of the South Florida front line, the right side for his defenders. And we saw him practicing this yesterday in the walkthrough and earlier today. He'll try to hit it on the top of the football and get that top spin. Let's see, but there it is. One big bounce. It's up in the air. Oh, they had an opportunity. And South Florida now, we'll get the football, and now the two teams are kind of huffing at each other a little bit, huffing and puffing. And
the ball has to go 10 yards before the kicking team can touch it. But it also looked like they were offsides before the kick even took place. So if that's the case, then they decline it. South Florida gets the ball. You're going to see here the kick, and it looks like there was a flag right away. You see the flag up in the air from the official, so that's clearly offsides. South Florida declines it. They get the ball, can run a couple of plays and ice the game.
First ever game at the FIU Stadium. New stadium, new attitude, new era is the slogan. The billboards all over Miami. They've had a big TV ad campaign. And that's the face of the program, Mario Cristobal, the first ever Cuban-born head coach in Division I football.
Number 31 on the kicking team. That penalty will be enforced from where South Florida recovered the ball. Then after the play was over, personal foul. Number 21 on South Florida, 15-yard penalty. It will be first down.
Theo Wilson came in late and shoved an FIU player.
Better be lucky he's not Theo Huxtable. Dr. Huxtable will be on him.
Jim Leavitt, man, he wants to get on that bus and get out of here as soon as possible. And he's seen some of his better players go down. Coming up, Fresno State, Toledo.
You know, these are the kind of games where you get a lead and then you kind of coast. And that's what I think South Florida did. Their defense just kind of went on cruise control. Lost some players. A lot of things happened. And George Selvey goes out. Bruce Mompremier gets hurt. There was just they lost their mental focus late in the game.
Yeah, clearly lost their edge. You're right. And that's the one thing that Leavitt stresses. You have to finish the job. And they did not do a good job of that tonight as Grothy goes down. No timeouts left for FIU, so they cannot stop the clock. And South Florida will go to 3-0 with a very tough road trip next week at NC State.
But, Doug, Florida Atlantic, Florida International, Central Florida, they all look at South Florida as a team we've got to beat in order for us to get to the next level. A few years ago, that wasn't the case. So now everybody's going to give them their best shot, especially the teams at home. We see East Carolina losing to North Carolina State. In-state rivalries are always tougher when you don't come prepared to play the full game.
Jim Leavitt and the South Florida Bulls were favored by 4 touchdowns. And they walk away with a 17-9 victory over Mario Cristobal and his Golden Panthers of FIU.
USF 17.
Our final score once again, South Florida 17-9. For more information, log on to your home for the finest in college sports at ESPNU.com. The proceeding has been an exclusive presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. Time now to send you to Fresno State at Toledo. That's next on ESPNU.